All right, we should be live streaming on YouTube right now if I did everything properly. Let me triple check. Make sure the volume's straight. Welcome. Today joining us, we're gonna have Austin Hull from Make Pop Music. You may have seen him on YouTube. We're about to kick up the Discord. So if you're hopping in with us and you wanna get your questions answered live, you gotta hop into our Discord. That's busyworksbeats.com/Discord. Click here to join the conversation. All right, and shout out to Nicole Nix. I want to pull up our website. We're about to do a crazy offer soon for a bundle offer. For those who haven't claimed the other Black Box bundle, we have a new bundle offer coming, and it's going to include a custom-made vocal tack from Nicole Nix. It's not out just yet.
Hey, Chevy, I see you.
But you can go to NicoleNix.com.
The High Class Rollers. 97031 in the booth.
For vocal tags.
Oh, Tommy Digital, you called for this.
So we're about to get started. Let me
switch. Damn, Prezi.
Let me switch over to Discord and then we'll be good to rock. So let's make sure everything's straight on the YouTube side and then we'll be good to go. So let me double check. Welcome everybody. Thank you for being patient with me. So again, Austin Hull is a master at pop music production. Let me turn this beat off. And vocal production, pop music production, he's insane. Like literally insanity when it comes to pop production. So we're gonna pick his brain today and see what he has to say. Let me hop over to Discord. Upgrade server profiles. You can set a different, no. I don't even know what that means. All right, let's get this event started. We got, let's let everybody know. Yes, start event. Chris Jr., thank you for hopping in. Oh, there he is right here. He's already here. Okay, give me a sec. Microphone check. Can you hear me? Oh, wait, I can't hear him. Let me double check, make sure all my stuff's right. Yeah, loop. Yeah, should be good to go. I can't hear you, but just let me know if you can hear me. Well, I guess you can't because I can't hear. Sometimes people have to push to talk on, or in the settings, it should be like a gear somewhere that allows you to switch your mic input and then the output. But it depends on if you're using mobile or if you're using a desktop. So let me just do my shout outs real quick. We got DJ Wraith says, thank you for all you do for us. Love you, bro. Thank you. Much love to you as well. Appreciate you. Nafi Beats is here. We got LA Winter. Sabanga Sanki Sabash, welcome. Drip Heavy's here. I want to win the FL. Yeah, also, I forgot. We're giving away FL Studio at the end of the stream, so stay tuned till the end if you want to be eligible. But if you didn't enter, you got to go to busyworksbeats.com/FL Studio. You guys just reminded me, I forgot to do one thing, but I'll do that towards the end. Leroy K is here. What's up? Let me make sure we got.
Check, check.
There you go. Now we hear you.
Cool. I just had to restart it.
Isn't that weird how like the one thing that works is just smacking the TV or.
I feel like, especially like on Windows, every time I get on any kind of like Zoom meeting or anything like that, I always have to like reset drivers. I'm just on an Apollo, so I don't really understand why, but a lot of the time on like Google Chrome, it'll like kick the driver or like the sound card off, so I have to like normally restart it.
You know more tech stuff than me. That sounds complicated, and the fact that you even know, the fact that you
Dude,
even
the
know.
Only reason I even found out is because I was doing a podcast, and like the person had to literally walk me through. I was like, I have no idea what any of this is.
Hilarious. But welcome, welcome. How you feeling tonight?
I'm doing good, man. How you doing?
Chilling, man. Chilling. I just want to pick your brain while we're live because. Yeah. Like there's a, you know, as a YouTube personality and somebody making content, you kind of know who's fluff and who's the real thing. You know what I mean?
Right.
So when I go to your, when I see your stuff up, I'm like, it's 100% guarantee that whatever he's talking about is super solid.
Thank you. I appreciate it. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, YouTube space is funny because like, I think that everybody has at least something good to say, but I think that we do see a lot of like people trying to, kind of like fluff themselves up a little bit, and then like I think it's really easy for people to kind of overstep their own boundaries. So like I'm a huge fan of no matter where you're at in your own journey, like if you can help anybody else that's trying to learn, or you know, if you have anything to share, I'm always a huge fan of that. But I think a lot of people try to like almost position themselves too much as an expert, and then you know it just comes back to kind of bite them. So I really, really appreciate the kind words.
Right. I tried to do K-pop and I was struggling, but I had to like finish the video, so I was like, you know what, I'm just gonna tell people to go somewhere else, because I was just hacking my way through it, like a genre that you might not be used to, for example.
Yeah, it's K-pop is super hard, especially too, because use like so many different, it feels like super polished bubblegum pop, but then they're using a bunch of these like jazz chords and like modulations and stuff like that, and the structures are really, really strange. Like a K-pop song almost feels like it'll have like four different separate beats that are kind of thrown into one thing, and then they modulate all over the place. So I've like tried my hand at it, but that is a tough one.
Right. There's like 17, it's like five different songs in one.
Yeah, dude, it's crazy. It's like so entertaining to listen to, but sometimes I'm on there and I'm like, I would never, ever, ever think to put like this kind of pre-chorus after the verse that we just had and connecting the chorus that we're about to get. It's wild.
Now, so I want to dig deep, because in the emails, I was telling everybody that I respect you as I see you as a genius of pop music and vocal production. I think those two pockets are what, to me at least, to an outsider, would make you stand out from everybody else, because there just aren't people who can teach it that thorough. And then on top of that, make something that sounds good. Because I remember a long time ago, it might have been 2 years ago, or 3 years ago, however long it was, I came across your video about like Taylor Swift, the most random artist, because I don't make Taylor Swift type music. But you were doing something with either Taylor Swift or Ariana Grande. I forget which one. And then you made a complete song and it sounded crazy. And then right after hearing that song, I bought I think it's called your, at the time it was called like the Everything Bundle or the Something Bundle with everything in it. And then, you know, I just had deep respect because I began to understand what I was chasing, which is I want to have the ability to create whatever I want at the blink of an eye. Does that make sense?
Yeah, I think that's kind of like where pop producers kind of have to sit. With pop being such a kind of general broad range, it's like you kind of do have to have that expertise in like all these different genres, and you have to have your tools ready for, you know, you can't just be sitting around flipping through a million different sample packs, because like, you know, I've done hip-hop stuff and I've done R&B stuff, and that is a lot more straightforward with like, you kind of know the sounds that you want to pull from, you know, like when in doubt, if you're doing an R&B song, just pull in 808s, pull in some like Rhodes, and then put a nice chord progression down. But with pop, they're like, it's such a wide genre that you don't really have those kind of sonic boundaries. So, like having the right tools and kind of having all of that in your pocket before you even sit into a session, I think it's like 90% of the battle for sure.
Right. And that's what I want to get into today, is becoming a real producer. I think a lot of folks, the way we all learn is trap, because it's the easiest thing to kind of get started. But then we get locked into a genre and we're not, I don't want to kind of create the debate, beat makers versus producers, but have you heard that debate before?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's something that, I think it is like a fair debate, but I think that we kind of live in an age now where like, they're becoming kind of the same thing. So like when I hear beat maker versus producer, I'm just still thinking of like somebody as a quote unquote beat maker, is like, they're just making a lot of 30 to 60 second kind of looped clips. They're kind of like getting their basis with production, but like if you produce a whole beat and then somebody else records the vocal, and like I feel like that's still a producer. I feel like so many people want to like gatekeep the term producer, and I don't think it has to be that specific, but I think that there are a lot of people that are doing production but might not be to that level of being able to produce a record for an artist yet, and that's where I sat for years.
Right. And that's where I hope to take these good folks today. So if you want to hop in the conversation, you guys got to hop over from YouTube over to Discord. The link is pinned in the YouTube chat. We got about 70 good folks on YouTube, and we got about 13 people over on Discord. So we're going to get this conversation rocking, and I really want to help the folks. That's why I kind of preface this by saying, give me 1 second. Shout out to my baby girl, Nicole Nix. Appreciate you. And I'll do a little exercise in a second, Austin, but I want to guide people from like that feeling stuck Because again, we're talked down to, specifically in the hip hop industry, we're talked down to as if we're like lesser than. So there's a lot of people who feel stuck, like they can't expand. They want to expand. They want to make Ariana Grande stuff. They want to learn how to do, you know, Justin Leroy, or I'm trying to think of other artists. Danny Lay, is that her name? Or Lee?
Yep.
Is it Lee or Lay? Danny Lay?
I have no idea. I'm not in a position to correct at all.
Right. Because you know that feeling of when you go into a studio and then a real musician starts playing and you just feel like you suck?
Definitely been there. Like, I definitely do get outplayed. But part of my philosophy is, like, I don't know. I don't want to be the best person in the room. If you're always the best person in the room, it means that you're not collaborating with enough people that are kind of pushing you. So I kind of get inspired by that. But sometimes it is overwhelming. It's like, oh, my God, I'm in way over my head.
Right. And that's what I want to open people's minds up for today. Quick exercise before we get rocking. I just do this ritual. So everybody who's on the YouTube chat, I need you guys to shout out Nicole Nix because we're about to drop a bundle, Austin. It's a very unique thing. But I need you to just show some love, put a heart, and then Nicole Nix, and then we'll get this thing rocking from the YouTube chat. All right. So also, if you're on Discord, you can raise your hand and hop up on stage. We're going to pick your brain, and then you're going to get some expert advice from us both. So Ric Flair, I saw your hand raised. Just got to do it one more time. All right. So we're going to let a couple folks up. And I like to start with questions so that we don't overly, because the biggest mistake I'm starting to learn, Austin, is that people talk way over us and we don't realize how the level people are. Yeah. What's up, Drippy?
Yeah. What's up, bro?
Yeah, we wanted to just pick your brain and kind of start off there. So, yes, what's on your mind? I'm going to do a quick video for my baby girl. Thank you.
I'm doing pretty good. Yeah, I just saw your advertise on YouTube. Hello?
Yes, what's on your mind, buddy? We're here to help you out.
Yeah, you kind of really inspired doing this. When I expected, I just literally watched like, well, I'm totally like a beginner, and like I really want to like learn how to like do all the beats and all that. Sometimes I get stuck, and like sometimes I just want to give up on myself. But at the end of the day, I just do it, and I just like watch like a lot of tutorials, and then do it, so like to help me like not to like, you know, to like to keep going, because like I really want to do this, because this is like a habit for me, and like. It's like just a little hobby when I'm not really doing nothing. I'm just kind of like nervous to talk to you guys because you guys are like, you know what I mean?
Nah, I feel you. I there's even me, like my whatever I've accomplished. I hop on the Clubhouse and you know what Clubhouse is, Austin?
I've heard of it.
Yeah.
I'll hop on Clubhouse and then I get on stage and it's like I'm frozen in time. It's like I don't even know what I'm saying. So I know that feeling. It's just... it's anticipation of hopping up on stage sometimes. Right. But what are your thoughts, Austin, on, and again, if you don't know his real name, he goes by Make Pop Music on YouTube for those who are wondering if the voice was familiar. It is familiar. Thank you, Drippy, for your question. I'm going to tuck you in VIP. So basically, real quick, Drippy, if you could just say your question back in one sentence real quick, just for everybody who just joined.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Wait, what do you want me to say?
Just if you could rephrase your question in one sentence, because we had a couple people hop in onto YouTube.
Or, about what I said?
Yeah, basically, I'll just say it for you. You basically said, no, it's all good. You basically said that when you're getting started, you just feel like there's a lot of information and you don't know how to move forward. You don't feel like you're progressing.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. All right, cool. I'll talk to you in VIP. Thank you, Drippy. So Austin, I'll let you kind of riff off of that and then we'll share thoughts. What are your thoughts?
Yeah, sounds great. I think most of us, no matter what level we're at in this chat or on the YouTube stream right now, have been in that position, or some of us are probably still in that position. For me, at least when I got started, it was definitely something similar as in like, I got started producing because I was just trying to make demos for a band that I was in. And it really started out of just like necessity to try to, you know, get our own ideas out there. Then I did just kind of fall in love with the process of it. So it kind of went from being a thing that I needed to do for my metal band into something that I enjoyed doing in my spare time. And so like my senior year of high school, going into college, I was producing all the time, like if I wasn't at school or if I wasn't hanging out with my wife in college, I would just literally always be producing. And it was definitely a hobby for years. It was something that anytime I had spare time, I would just hop into my DAW and make whatever ideas I had. I made a lot of bad ideas. I made a few good ideas. And it was just one of those things that over the years, you just do have to kind of learn your tools, learn the basic techniques, kind of figure out what your workflow is. And I think it's really important to kind of take in as much information as possible, which is great because now we have all of these YouTube channels. We have, you know, Make Pop Music, Busy Works Beats. We have a bunch of others that are doing really, really, really good quality content that weren't there, you know, 10 years ago. I think just kind of taking in that information and kind of trying out different things that people are letting you know about is huge. And then I think being able to kind of narrow back some of those things. So it's kind of like take everything in, listen to all of the options, but then narrow it down to kind of what works for you. So, you know, if I watch a video, Dave Pensado, and he's telling me how to EQ a vocal, and I try it, and it sounds great when he does it, but it doesn't sound great when I do it, that's fine. I at least gave it a shot. I know that that's a tool that I can pull out if I need it, but it's something that I'm not going to lean towards. And I think that that just happens over time, and it just happens with a bunch of trial and error. So definitely don't rush the process. I think as long as you legitimately just love doing this and you're doing it for you, I don't think that there's any kind of time frame or any kind of, you know, necessity that you need to put on it. Just keep learning, you know, as fast as you can. Do it as much as possible, and it'll eventually come second nature to you.
Oh, good man. I like that take. And Mad Hatter over on YouTube says, shout out Drippy, the next Metro. Shout out to Drippy. Apparently, he's deemed as the next Metro Boom, and we'll see. Maybe he started in the Discord fam and then is going to blow up. To as Clubhouse would say, the piggyback off of what Austin is saying here is that without going into a college level thing about it, there's four levels of competency. This is how we learn anything. There's unconscious incompetence, which means you don't know that you don't know something. There's conscious incompetence, which means you know that you don't know something. There's conscious competence, which means you know that you know something. And then there's unconscious competence, which means you don't know that you know something. It's back of hand. It's habit. So where the most exciting place to live is in music production or learning anything is when you transfer things from the unconscious incompetence, meaning you don't know that you don't know, and you pull them up to the conscious incompetence. That's where you're going to find the most excitement in life, is when you can't see anything and then you see it all of a sudden. It's new. It's a discovery. So the more you introduce discovery into your learning process, you'll be hooked. You'll be up till 8 a.m. some nights. You won't even feel like you're tired. That's the real secret to keep going, is when you're learning all these techniques. And one last thing I'll say is that I think, you know how they say, Austin, you know how they say, like, practice makes perfect?
Absolutely.
I agree to a degree. I agree to a degree. So I say perfect practice makes perfect, because I can learn how to do karate from, you know, John's dojo down the street, or I can learn karate from the sensei who's a master of all jujitsu or something like that. I think that's two different martial arts. I don't even know. My point is, you can learn from the Austins in the world. You know, Austin's channel, Make Pop Music, you'll learn the perfect process. And then as you have that structure, you can experiment with the ideas that, you know, a random YouTuber pulls up, and look at it like an experiment or a lab. Because the biggest problem I'll see is that people get stuck in bad habits, and it blocks them for a long time. So I think there's merit to both approaches here. So we'll kick it to the next good folks, and I'll keep letting everybody up. So again, if you want to hop in the conversation, just go to busyworksbeats.com/YouTube. I'll link it in the YouTube chat. I mean, sorry, busyworksbeats.com/Discord is how you join the conversation. And then I'll let people up on stage to ask Austin a question, and we'll kind of pick apart your questions and pick out the value. So we got 978 Nate. What's up, buddy?
What up?
He's like, what up? Are you a crypt? Are you a punk holder, or is that just for aesthetics?
I'm sorry?
Do you hold the NFTs called the CryptoPunks?
Oh, no. My Discord got hacked a little bit ago, so I just needed something to put over the profile picture.
Oh, darn. I was about to say, man, put me on game. So what's on your mind? Yeah.
So basically, going back off about what you were saying earlier, like perfect practice makes perfect. Like, what are your thoughts on, you know, colleges and the different routes that you can take to learning?
I'm gonna let Austin start that one off because I already go ahead. I can go for 35 minutes, but go ahead.
Yeah. First of all, what's up, Nate? Hope all is well. Oh, I didn't go to school for production. I actually went to college. I got a degree in education, so I was gonna go to school to be a high school English teacher. By the time I graduated, I was already a full-time producer and was already making a full-time income. So I never did like step into the classroom. But with that said, I kind of learned everything just from trial and error, looking up YouTube videos myself, joining communities, and just kind of making as much stuff as possible. And that for me was a really, really good path. I was able to learn at my own pace. I was able to start my own business at my own pace. I was able to find artists to work with at my own pace. I have no regrets about not going to school for music production or music in general. With that said, everybody's different. I think some people do benefit from structured learning. So I have a lot of friends that have gone to school for music because that's just the way that they like to learn. They are a lot more analytical with music than I am. So they're big into like music theory. They're big into like studying arrangements at like a fundamental level. And that to them makes a lot of sense. And they can kind of put that together and that kind of helps them build their tool belt. For me, I've never been good with music like that. I don't know much theory. I just have like really, really, really good relative pitch. I kind of play everything by ear and I kind of just like to learn as I go. So I knew that if I went to school for it, it wouldn't serve me. It would probably just burn me out and it's not the way that music makes sense to me. I think that there really is no right or wrong method. I do think some people, we spend a lot of time and a lot of money going to school if that's not the right fit for them. And then I think that some people might be losing potential because they're not looking into that if that is a good fit for them. So it's one of those things of like, definitely give it a shot, you know, see if you even like doing it, see what you like about production or writing and see what you don't like about it. And then once you kind of figure out what you need to learn, I think that's where you can figure out where the best avenue is going to be to pick that up. And school has its benefits. It's definitely still kind of the traditional route for I want to go get a degree in engineering. I want to go get an internship as a runner at a big studio. I want to become an assistant engineer at that studio. And then maybe over 15 or 20 years, work your way up to be a producer or head engineer at that studio. Still a totally valid thing. I think right now, it's not the only way to get there like it used to be. Like you could definitely just go produce a song that pops off on TikTok and then work with the biggest artists in the world next week. So I don't think that you have to go to school like back in the day they said that you did. But I also don't think that you should just totally write it off if you think that that might be a good learning strategy for you in particular.
Right. And I want to back up what Austin's saying. So there's a lot of folks who just joined on the YouTube stream. We got Austin Hall from Make Pop Music. It's a crazy, insane YouTube channel. If you're not subscribed, this man is like every video makes my videos look like kindergartner videos. It's just very dense with wisdom. And hearing your story, because I didn't know your backstory as much, Austin, hearing that you just kind of do this based on just your experience alone, that even amplifies to show you guys that what's possible. And you're not being held back by some mysterious force. I'll tell you, Austin, like the level of stuff that you're doing on your YouTube, for example, just regular videos. There's colleges who literally hire folks like Austin and I to teach their kids. Okay, so I want that to sink in for everybody who doesn't understand the real world. You guys ready? Colleges hire us to teach their students. So what does that tell you about college as far as like traditional music? Now, you did make good points about engineering. One thing that I will say that is a little difficult to learn offline, and I can't say it's impossible, is just the cables and the engineering and understanding physics and soldering and all that type of stuff. That side of music is a little geeky, and I will say you need some type of study to understand physics, signal routing, you know, just DBs, all that type of like geeky stuff. I will say there's a little bit of math.
Soldering stuff, all that kind of stuff.
Yeah, that type of stuff. You know, you could spend a couple thousand and learn that. Now, would I go $80,000 into student debt to learn music? No, I went to school for biology, pre-med, which is way different than music. I just happened to be able to apply some of the techniques. So I'm backing exactly what Austin says. I just want you guys to know that you're learning from people who teach, the people who teach at the university. So this is like, you're already in the right spot. So 978, did that help your perspective a little bit?
Yeah, definitely. I definitely gained some insight. Can I say a couple things before I get VIP'd off here?
Oh, is that a thing, VIP'd? Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. I don't know, but first off, I want to say that lately I've been feeling very, like, not no drive to make music. And ever since I kind of joined your Discord and started, you know, like Awesome was saying, joining communities and just being around people that are better than you, and has really motivated me to start making music again, especially at a whole different level. And I also wanted to say that I'm definitely a big fan. Busyworks Beast is the first time I've ever had an interaction with you. And Austin, I'm definitely gonna be checking out your stuff.
Thank you so much, man. Appreciate it.
Oh, I love you, man.
Appreciate you guys' time, man. I appreciate you even vocalizing with me, you know.
Oh, you're the best, Nate. Thank you, man. I deeply appreciate that. Love you too, man. Appreciate that. And it's because he made good points, is that joining the community, for example, is a part of it. Because even myself, like, our community was like, we never had a place where we could all talk to each other. This is the first place we've ever had to talk to each other in real time, whether it's voice channel, whether it's live streaming. You could do cookups in here. We have people who cook up almost every day, and they're teaching people. I think that's what separates this Discord city, Austin, from like a lot of other Discords, is that the people who are here are willing to share information, and that's what kind of creates this group thing of everybody being on the same page. Thank you, Nate.
One more thing. I'm sorry. Yeah, I know. Other people got to talk, but I really do agree with that, because I feel like this space has given me a lot of confidence to actually talk to people instead of just watching and listening. And I'm actually being engaged in a conversation. I'm actually, you know, meeting people and having relationships with people, and it's very beneficial.
Oh, that's even better that people are like being sociable and personable. That's the best part. Thank you for giving me that report, because that's the one thing that I can't architect, is like how people are going to interact. You know what I mean?
Exactly.
Good, man.
We'll add... got to hop into more questions. But before, I just wanted to say one thing just to kind of piggyback off of that whole community aspect.
Yeah.
And we probably won't get into it for this live stream, but maybe I can talk about it another time. I built my entire career off of making a Facebook group, and it was completely accidental. So don't underestimate the power of community and meeting producers and meeting artists, and to take yourself decently seriously online, because you never know who you could be communicating with. You never know if, you know, Jason Joshua is going to be in here, or you never know if, you know, the kid Leroy is going to be watching your TikTok. So yeah, that community aspect right now is like the biggest thing to build a career, and you might actually build a career and not even mean to.
Right. Yeah, definitely. I've never felt so inspired, bro, ever since I joined here. And I didn't even join thinking anything of it. I was like, oh, okay, it's a Discord with a bunch of people who make beats and shit.
Well, wait till we bring in the big dogs. Like, Austin is one of the big dogs. I consider a top dog. Now, wait until we bring in, like, the folks who, like, Jason Joshua's mixing engineer, or, I mean, excuse me, assistant engineer, or people who mix for Chris, like, the top. It's a small circle of people. We're all friends. I just got to invite them in. So, I mean,
even the small group of people that I've talked to, you know, it seems like they have gone such long ways within their own lives and stuff, and it's like crazy that they even give me the time of day to talk to me. Like, you don't have to talk to me, but you give the time out of your day.
This is one big huge producer family over here. That sounds so corny. We're a producer city over here. Producer city, there we go. We just
need a nation
over here. We need a flag, we need an icon. And thank you, Nate. I just want to clear up some visual space. I could let a couple more people up here.
Yeah, of course, of course.
So add Nate, y'all, as a friend on Discord. Add him as a, what do you call it? I think a friend is what they call it on here. Who was next? Do you know Austin? Was it Mick?
I did not see. I don't know if this comes up in chronological order.
Mickey D. I don't know how to pronounce your whole name there. Mick Dan a dog. We heard you for a second.
Hello?
Yeah, can you
hear me?
There you go.
I've been producing since high school and trying to. I had all your courses in that back in around the time the pandemic hit, and then everything got hacked, and I had lost everything I had bought from you guys. But you've helped me out a lot. But my issue is when I write a song and try to make a beat for it, the beat doesn't work with the song. Either I'm making a happy song, it'll be a sad song, or making a sad song, the beat will turn out happy.
That's a deep question. I want to pick Austin's brain on this. And thank you, by the way, for your business. And if you just write this email down real quick, not to kind of make this a long thing, But it's info, I-N-F-O, at busyworksbeats.com. My team will restore all your stuff for you.
Thank you. Let me go to my notepad and get.
Okay, dope. Notepad. I'll remind you before you. So, Austin, what are your thoughts on that as far as the intention behind songwriting? Happy or sad?
Yeah, I think this is, again, kind of one of those things that just comes back to experience and kind of like think that you have to make so many ideas. You have to make good ideas. You have to make bad ideas. You have to make ideas that don't match. And I think it's just kind of trying everything. And then eventually you'll kind of develop that innate sense to understand that a song, or even at a more basic level, a, you know, synth preset or a chord progression fits the vibe that you're going for. So I feel like just developing some of the basic skills of, you know, some like very, very, very basic music theory of like, these chords sound happy, these chords sound sad, playing it in a cadence like this feels uplifting, playing it in, you know, a cadence like this feels like it's kind of dragging, which can make the mood feel a little bit more somber. Those are things that, you know, as we've said before, you kind of have to just learn and pick up, whether that's on YouTube or through a course that you get or by trial and error. But it's one of those things that, like, when you do play a chord progression and it feels sad, kind of make a mental note of that. So when you have an artist that sends you a brief or a lyric or a vocal a cappella that feels like it fits that vibe, you kind of have something that you can pull out of your head. You might not be able to copy the same exact chord progression. If you have, you know, for instance, the mental note that, oh, I played a chord progression in C minor and it sounded sad, maybe you can try to play another chord progression in C minor and it'll at least fit that vibe. And then once you have some of those basic tools, that's where you can start kind of experimenting and exploring. So I think it's just about having the small little bit of knowledge to shortcut some of the trial and error, so you're not trying everything on every single project, but you kind of have a more narrow field of like, okay, I at least know I need to try this sprout, I want to try this vibe, I can pull in this synth preset, and then you can just kind of start building it from there rather than, you know, spending 3 hours trying a million different chord progressions to nail the vibe.
Deep. I just read it. And to, I guess, piggyback off your concepts, J. Myth said this. He says, happy melodies are low-key dark, sad melodies underneath. Check out the nursery rhymes, for example. Ring around the... Wait, how's it go? Wait, ring around the rosy, pocket full of dozies, ashes, ashes, we all fall down. Isn't that crazy? It's talking about like some kind of plague or something. I think it's lyrics too. Happy birthday to you. Is that sad? Is the happy birthday song sad? I don't know.
I know. I also, I think that like, don't get too caught up in feeling like a sad song has to sound sad. My favorite songs in the world are songs that are cripplingly depressing, but sound super fun if you're just listening at a surface level. So maybe that's the vibe.
There's a song by, what is that band called? Some Rage Against the Machine. And it's called like Party or something. It had a dope hook, but it was talking about how the world is like chaotic or something like that. I forget the song name.
All those 90s songs are like so doom and gloom, and you're just like, this was playing a coming of age movie. This is like the gnarliest thing.
Oh, do you know that song? Everybody wants to have a real good time. That song. So somebody in the chat knows that song. Whoever sings that song's about like revolution, but the hook is about like partying. It's crazy. Yeah, we got a lot of folks up here. So, Mickey D, did that help you?
Yeah, it did. But the only reason why I lost all your courses and instruments and that was because they hacked my accounts. So I lost like all my email.
Oh, gotcha. We'll get you straight. That's not a big thing, but it's just info, I-N-F-O, at busyworksbeats.com, and my team will send it out as quick as possible. But yeah, there's another thing with music theory specifically. When you go downward with the music, the notes, it sounds sad. I can make a major chord sound sad depending on like the direction in which you go. Like when you go upward, it sounds happy. When you go downward, it sounds sad. That's a quick little rule to help you out, Mickey D.
There
you
go. That's what I need to pull up. What's that email again?
Info, I-N-F-O, at busyworksbeats.com. Cool. And then we'll handle the back end. I'll tuck you in VIP because I just want to clear up some of the stage space. Who was, let's go, NG Menace. What's up?
Hey, what's going on, my man?
There he is, suited up.
Hey, what's going on? Can you hear me?
Yes. What's on your mind?
Yeah, I just want to let you know I've been doing music for like about since I was 14. I'm about 32 now. I just want to know like what's keep the passion going, because I went from like 90s music and now I'm into today's music and I'm not really, you know, clicking with the vibe. So it's like I'm getting a lot of writer's block, beat block, and a lot of things like that.
Okay, yeah, I'm curious to hear Austin's, because he's, like, in his creativity is so dense that making YouTube videos, you could run through all your ideas in a week. So I'm curious, how do you keep the excitement, even as a person who's been teaching other people how to do it?
Yeah, for sure. I think we're all going to run into writer's block at some point. I think if you have a specific style of music that you really enjoy making and listening to, I don't think you necessarily have to conform to modern music. I think we're kind of in this weird age right now with music and art and fashion and everything. We're kind of, every generation is back in style. So you walk down the street, you'll see somebody in 60s bell bottoms, you'll see somebody in a 90s crop top, and you'll see somebody in a 2000s body chain. And I think the same thing is happening with music. Like if I go on the radio right now, I can hear Olivia Rodrigo's doing like 70s inspired fin punk, or I can hear Lil Nas is doing super current polished pop, and then you've got artists like Ed Sheeran who are kind of doing like the 2000s singer songwriter. So I don't think that you kind of have to box yourself in. I think that if there's a genre or a time period that feels really, really good to you, just keep doing that, and you might find ways and tools and techniques that you can kind of modernize that. And I think that's been a huge thing that's happened like in the past couple of years with like 80s music and pop music. So we're hearing tons of retro synths come back. We're hearing the more upbeat retro drums. We've got The Weeknd doing it on his album. Post Malone's doing it now. Justin Bieber did it on his album. And that'll eventually happen with the 90s or with hip-hop or with R&B. It's just one of those things, like, keep working on whatever you really feel like working on. I wouldn't worry too much about what the charts are doing. If a song's a hit, a song's a hit. It's really not going to matter what the genre or subgenre is. And then other than that, just in terms of, like, having writer's block, me personally, if I have writer's block, what I'll do is listen to different types of music that I still enjoy but that I might not listen to super regularly. So for instance, if I'm working on a ton of pop music, maybe I go listen to like a film score, or maybe I'll go listen to like like R&B from the 70s, or maybe I'll go listen to like Motown or something like that, just so I can hear different chord progressions, different melodies, different instruments and timbres, and that starts to kind of spark and inspire ideas that I can throw in to my own personal current style. Then also too, sometimes you just need time away. Sometimes you need to just step out of the studio, go live your life, make experiences, go to the bar with your friends, go on that vacation, because that's really what we're pulling from when we make music. We want to have emotions, we want to have experiences that we can embody. And you're, you know, spending all of your time making music, you'll eventually run out of resources.
Big facts. I just got a college level, in a dense small amount of time, you just got the college level answer to that, which is, and how, I want to ask you this as a question on top of a question. And for everybody who just joined, we have Austin Hull here from Make Pop Music. To me, I deem him as probably one of the best, if not the best, educators in the music space, specifically when it comes to quality and the technique. It's supreme. Like, I've seen, you know, we've heard the Rick Beatos, the Adam Neelys, the Beat Academy, shout out to Ill Factor from Beat Academy. He's in our mastermind. But there's just only like,
I love Ill.
Yeah, shout out to Ill Factor. And there's only like a couple people who can really do this, like on that level. And Austin's just on that level. That's the top tier, in my opinion. And so that's who we have here with us. So I want you guys to formulate your questions to really pick the brain of somebody who has a dense amount of experience and wisdom in the pop lane, the pop production, pop vocal production. So we can get, you know, into technique as well. I don't want you guys to think this is only about mindset. But going back, Austin, just about the block thing, it goes back to those four levels of competency, in my opinion, is that we get excited when we take the unknowns and then we make them known, even if we don't know what it means. So for example, when I'm hopping into crypto, I don't know anything about anything. So what do? I just observe. I just watch stuff change. I just observe stuff. And once I see the observation, then I mark it down as a word. I say, okay, NFT. I don't know what NFT means. That's the excitement that you're going to get, is when you discover things that you don't know. And a lot of people think they know everything in music, so they feel stuck. it's our own brain blocking us because we think we know everything and we don't know everything. So we just have to break it down into the components, the micro components of something. Like Austin said, analyze the Weeknd song. Is it just 80s drums and 80s chords, or do you know the exact synthesizer that they used, the exact year, the waveform of the synthesizer? Do you know how the circuitry works in the synthesizer? You can always break it down all the way down, and just there's so much knowledge to get. So NG, does that help your process when it comes to beat block specifically?
Yeah, give me another outlook. Also have another question, like far as like if you've been doing music for a while, you know, you're talented and everything, and you don't know nobody, like how do you get to yourself to where you get to network more? Because usually when you're doing music and you don't know nobody, it feel like you're doing it for no reason, no purpose, really. Like you could be
right,
real talented and knowledgeable.
Yeah, like doing music, but it has no outlet. Is that what you mean?
Yeah, pretty much. Like, no, you don't have nobody to network with. You don't have nobody to get your music out to. So it's like you're kind of doing it for no reason, you know, or you feel like you're doing it for no reason.
Right. So you have a two-part question. One is how to get your music out there. And then the other part of the question is how do you properly network? I'm going to let Austin kick this off because I have a lot of structure around this. What are your thoughts?
Yeah, I mean, you're doing it right now. You're in a Discord that's got 9,000 people. You're chatting with people, you know, come into places like this, come into places like we have a Facebook community where we have like almost 30,000 people. Post your stuff, get feedback, get opinions, give your feedback on stuff other people are doing. You know, make friendships. Almost all of probably my first 400 paying clients were friends or at least like decent contacts that I had like constant communication with before they ever hired me for a project. All of that came remotely. Like I've done probably about $500,000 in projects that were all done remotely from people that I met online. And it's just, it's one of those things that like you literally just have to chat with people. Anytime somebody has a conversation, hop in, offer any advice that you have, get any advice that anybody else wants to give. And you know, places like this or like our Facebook community or like other Facebook communities or YouTube channel comment sections, those are amazing places to kind of meet people. So we kind of live in the digital age where like these are virtual coffee shops that you can just go meet very like-minded people that are into the same things that you're into. So definitely don't undervalue the opportunity for relationships just because they might be over a screen, because there's probably a lot of people in here who would want to get to know you and who would listen to your music or who might hire you to help them create a song or might buy an exclusive from you. So you just never know.
Right, and I'll going back, I forgot to add something, is when it comes to beat block, there's three causes for beat block. One is you don't have an intention. Think about every studio session on the pro level. They don't go in the studio like, I don't know what I'm gonna do today. I'm just gonna pay $120 an hour to sit here and figure it out. Like, unless you're Kanye with a Rockefeller budget, that's not happening. So people go into the studio with an idea. And I think because music production has become so easy, we just open our computer and just sit there. And we're like, why aren't ideas coming to my head? But if you look at Ryan Leslie's stuff, if you look at all the top pros who are spending hundreds of dollars an hour, they can't waste time. They don't go in there without an idea. So that's the first one, is not having an intent or an idea to begin with. The second one is deviating from your intention. So when I say I want to create a blue popsicle, and I go to create the blue popsicle and I accidentally spill red in there and it becomes purple, it's that deviation that it triggers our discovery mechanism that gets us excited. But the problem is we're not creating what we initially wanted to create. So that's why I said we want to separate the lab experimental stuff from the product stuff. There's a system to create a song every single time. When you're experimenting and doing the lab stuff, that's when you kind of find new things to try out, and it's a balance. And then thirdly, the reason we have beat block is simply just lack of knowledge. That's why I love having these conversations, and I can respect an Austin Hull because he's like top of the top when I say on picking knowledge. I like some pros, Austin, how do you feel about this? There are pros like a Mike Dean. I'm just throwing Mike Dean under the bus right now. Hopefully he doesn't get mad, but shout out, I love Mike Dean. But like a Mike Dean, or who's like a famous producer? Like even Timbaland. Shout out to Timbaland. Hey, I love Timbaland too. But there are certain pros, they have all this knowledge, but it's not like they're not showing us anything. Does that make sense?
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. I think it definitely takes a certain kind of person to want to kind of peel back their layer. I think that it might be a generational thing. I think that, you know, back in the day, production communities were a lot more tight-knit. There weren't really, like, Facebook communities. And really, once you made it, you know, once you were at Timbaland, you really didn't have much competition. And I think that, you know, if Timbaland was giving away his secrets in 2002, it would put a huge damper on his business, where somebody like Ian Kirkpatrick going and doing two-hour live streams on Twitch doesn't care, because by the time somebody watches that Twitch stream about the Dua Lipa song that he did, he's already on to the next style. I think things right now are evolving so fast that producers have no problem showing what they're doing in real time, because these are all just tools to kind of help us create better art in the future, where maybe some of the older producers were more focused on preservation rather than exploration, and I think that they had all nailed down the sound so well, we're just a little bit nervous to kind of give that away, which, I mean, is totally rightful, but I think it's definitely just like with social media and with visual media and with the way that the radio changes now, I don't think that's really an option anymore.
Right, that's the beautiful part. I think we, me and yourself, have created the culture to share information. I think there was this kind of hoard information to keep a competitive edge type of mindset back in the 90s and everything, because they didn't have power, specifically in the hip hop community. When opportunity isn't created by you and it comes from somebody else, you're always trying to guard it because you don't have control over opportunity. And that's why a lot of those early producers from the hip hop specifically, they were holding that information, because they're like, look, I don't control these placements. I just am the guy who gets it done. And I think we're shifting that, Austin, is getting people to share, whether it's loops, information, whatever. And then they realize if they share more, those seeds become trees and plants over time. And then people actually give you opportunities for helping them out when they were just beginning. That's kind of the crazy part about it. We can go on and on and on. But NG, just to answer you about the networking part, you got to come to the table with something. You can't go into a room with no value and be like, add me to your $1 million operation. That's just not how anything works. You got to bring something to the table. And, you know, everybody has a supply and demand. You know, everybody has a need for something. So it could be, it's not always going to be music, though. So that's, once you realize that everybody's need is not music, then you'll start to understand how to properly network. I have a whole video about it. It's in our business course. I think it's in the premium section. It's a little too much to go through because it's very deep. But you got to have something in hand. It's just not going to be a handout.
I feel you on that, and I appreciate everything you do. And it's just like, if you have it on hand, it's just like the hard part is meeting the right people, you know, in my situation.
Right. Sometimes it's just, like you said, knowing the right people. I'm going to tuck you in VIP to clear up some space. But yeah, I can go on and for days and days and days about networking, because I was just in Miami just to specifically network. Ric Flair, I think you're up next. I think so.
How you doing?
Chilling. What's on your mind, buddy?
First off, you know, I appreciate everything you do. Austin Hall, I'm going to be checking you out because I need to see what's going on with you as well. You know?
I appreciate that.
Shout out to every producer on here. You know, we all up here, we all trying to get things done, of course. My problem that I've ever had mostly is right now is with mastering. You know, it's not like, okay, I'm 48 years old, man. Look, I've been doing this for a very long time. I went from analog to digital. So it's kind of, when I switched over and like NG was talking about, also making beats from 90s going into the 2000s. And I mean, trying to even keep up from 2010 right now. I just caught up to the wave right now.
Right.
You know, but my most problem is like mastering, basically. Mixing, I have no problem with. Making a beat, I don't have a problem with.
Dope. That's a good question. I'm sure a lot of folks have that question on their mind. So thank you, Rick. And, you know, I always share my process. I'm curious to hear your process, Austin, about, because you have a lot more tracks. Most of our tracks is, you know, maybe 10 tracks max. How many tracks on average do you use, do you think?
An average pop song is probably like 150 to like send.
Oh, he said average.
I did one 2 weeks ago. like 220, but I like, it's not a bunch, it's not all the same stuff happening at the same time. Like, you have to understand, like, it might be a track that there's a riser that happens one time, but there's like 40 different risers throughout the song, so it's like, could probably consolidate all down to like 30. But I, you know, I mix and master in my production sessions, so I just leave it all there so I can kind of tweak it however much I need to. But yeah, the question about mastering is a great question. Curious to hear everybody else's opinion, but like, as a producer, I do mix my own productions and master my own productions quite often. I think mastering is one of those things that there's a lot of misinformation online about. There's a lot of like, you want to keep, you know, negative 14 LUFS, you want to do this on your master chain, you want to do that on your master chain. I think that mastering is the one area that people are super scared to experiment, because it's the last step of the process, right? So like, if you clip your master bus, whole song's ruined. But I think that it's just about learning some of those more modern tools. So kind of like getting a good limiter, figuring out kind of where you like to sit within that limiter. It's getting a good master bus compressor and kind of trying these things and doing a couple masters that might be a little over compressed or a little too loud, doing a couple that might be a little bit too quiet. And while you're learning those tools, pull in records that you feel are good representations of what a solid current master is. So like, even the other day, I pulled in a Lil Nas record. There was a mix and a master on that that was like fantastic, and the low end was perfect, and it was loud, but it wasn't like distorting, so I dragged it in. Was using, I think, Metric AB to kind of flip back and forth to kind of see. It's just about like doing those references, kind of figuring out where you can push things to without ruining it, kind of finding that super, super thin line of like, here's what I can do, here's how I can enhance the song, here's how I can enhance the feeling of the song, enhance the listener's experience, but not go overboard where it's straying too far away from the original mix. And I think that there are mastering engineers that can explain all of this and do all of this much better than I can. There are people that have built $100,000 rooms where they literally only master songs. So, you know, maybe link up with one of them, like we were just kind of talking about, you know, building these relationships where you have something to offer. I don't think it's a bad idea for every producer or every mixing engineer to have a mastering engineer in their pocket, even if they, you know, like to master their own stuff. I've got probably four or five different people that if I'm just not nailing the master, I'll hit them up. I know their rates, I can afford them, I'll, you know, bill it to the client, and if it serves the song and it does better than me, that's fine. I just have to put my ego to the side and let another professional do their job. And then, once you kind of, you know, say I hire another mastering engineer, I'll take that master back and I'll compare it to the things that I try. I'll say, what did they get that I wasn't getting? You know, was the top end more clear? Was the low end more controlled? And then form a conversation. Be like, hey, what did you do to this low end? Because there was just nothing I could do in my master process that did even close. That's a really, really good tool to have, is like kind of mixing the trial and error and mixing the kind of collaborative networking process, being something where you can learn from them, they can help you out, you're supporting them, you're supporting another engineer. It's just kind of a win-win for everybody.
Right on. I need y'all to smash that like button for Austin.
I like that.
Real quick, yeah, okay. I need y'all to smash the like button for Austin, because he's given his real experience. And that's what I appreciate, is he has no reason to hold back information. Like, a lot of people are sponsored by companies and they're all shilling towards a certain project. I feel like he's giving you pure information, and that's what I can respect, because very few people can hop on the YouTube without having a gazillion sponsors and like leaning to one side when it comes to information. And like you said, you could link up with folks. And I didn't mean to cut you off, Rick. I just wanted to shout out to the chat, because we had over 150 people here, and I want to just honor Austin while he's here and let everybody know how to find him. So his link is in the YouTube video description, and that's where you can subscribe to his YouTube channel specifically if you want to follow up on his content. My bad, Rick. Didn't mean to interrupt.
Nah, you good, brother. It's all good. I appreciate you guys, man. Hey, I keep up with you, busy man. Keep doing your thing. Austin, I'm going to check you out, brother. Much love, man.
Appreciate it, man. Much love.
Good man. Yeah, I think people overcomplicate mastering too. I mean, like, for the average person, like, are y'all going to get your masters to sound like freaking Mike Tucci, or I'm trying to think of, I don't know who you guys know as mastering engineers, but
like a Sterling Sound or something like that.
Yeah, it's like, are y'all gonna really make it sound exactly like that Drake record? Maybe not, but using the reference will help you at least understand how loud it is in comparison to what people are used to, like just used to in their car. for example.
The great part about mastering is, like, it's the last 5% anyway, so as long as you don't completely ruin it, you might not inch out everything that you put in the track, but it's, like, pretty hard to ruin a song with a master unless you just master it way too quiet or you way, way, way overdo it. So, like, thin out, just find a reference and get it as good as you can, and if you're having a lot of issues with the master, maybe revisit the mix, or, like I said earlier, just link up with a mastering engineer. Like, there are people that that's literally all they do. Their ears are just fine-tuned for that, so, make some connections in that field.
Right, and I just learned about a video from this, like, mastering engineer who's, like, supreme. He uses Isotope RX 8 or 9 or whatever it is to do, like, some, I forget what it's even called, like, phase something, where he, like, shifts the phase to make the song louder. Just stuff like that. Like, there's a level of mastering that's super high level. What you guys need, for the most part, you said Pensado's place. Shout out to Dave Pensado. You guys need a, this is why I respected what you said, a good bus compressor, meaning a good compressor that works on a lot of instruments at once. I came across this thing called the MKS. Have you heard of it, Austin?
Think so. Who's it by?
MKS. It's by Weiss, Weiss.
Matthew Weiss?
No, not Matthew Weiss. DS1 MK3, that's what it's called. DS1. Shout out to Matthew Weiss too. He used to teach on YouTube. Does he still put stuff out on YouTube?
Yeah, I think he just started a new channel, I think, called Weiss Advice. Oh, I do have this. Yeah, I have the plugin. I pay for the Plugin Boutique subscription. So yeah, I definitely have this. I've never used it though.
That, to me, that's the most transparent compressor I've ever heard in my entire life. It's called the Weiss DS1 MK3. Like you said, though, it's the tool. Like, I'll just give you guys a secret. You guys ready? I'm going to shatter everything you ever have known about everything. So I need you guys to smash the like button, because I'm about to expose so many people in the music production space who are making plugins. You guys ready? Give me what emoji should they give me, Austin, to let me know that they're ready?
Do the brain blast emoji.
These are the brain blast emoji. Give me one of these, y'all. If you have your updated phone, give me one of those emojis, and then I'll give you guys a secret. I'm gonna give you guys 1 minute to do that.
Wait. 30 seconds remaining.
Maybe 30 seconds to put that emoji, because I'm about to expose it. Here's what it is. You guys ready? So, a lot of the compressors, the reason I respect Austin saying that about having the right tools is because a lot of compressors, a lot of EQs, a lot of, what else do people have? Whatever the plugin is, it's recycled code. The only thing that changes is the user interface. In other words, without the geek speak, it just means that you're buying the same plugin over and over and over and over and over and over and over again from all these companies. The only thing that changes is the knobs that they put on the front. Okay, so when you have companies like Weiss, the Weiss, I forgot what it was even called, the Weiss DS1 MK3, the architecture on the inside is actually different. So you're going to get an actual different result that sounds supreme. And they have a bundle there. That's the best bundle I've seen. Do you use Isotope stuff, Austin?
Yeah, Isotope, they hooked me up like a couple years ago with like a bunch of their stuff, and I use it all the time, like especially the... like the RX series for like, as a producer and a mixer that's getting a lot of vocals from people, like the D Room, the D Reverb, the D Click, like all of that stuff is a lifesaver. But then I love all the Ozone stuff for just like stereo imaging. They have a really good like multi-band exciter that is great for like doing different like multi-band saturation. They're cool. That again, I'm all for companies that like are kind of pushing the envelope. The Weiss EQ or the Weiss compressor that you were talking about is by Softube. Pretty much everything they do is insane, so I'm not surprised that it bends.
Right, and so just to give you guys a quick recommendation on plugins you need, a bus compressor, which is basically a group compressor, something like an SSLG channel strip type compressor. You're gonna need a saturator. I like the there's a free one by Softube called Saturation Knob. You could get that one for free. And then you guys need a limiter, a good limiter. So that's really all you need in my, like, I've done this recently. I mean, as far as like a cheat sheet, little mastering chain, that's what you guys can use. Hopefully that helps.
I have a video on it on our channel. If anybody's watching, if you just go to makepopmusic.com, I did a whole video where I basically show the mastering chain that I use on everything. Sometimes I'll like swap around different parameters to suit the song, obviously, but Yeah, I mean, it really is. It's boiled down to, like, a bus compressor. I'm using VBC Red by Slate Digital, and then Saturn from FabFilter for saturation. And then I use a linear phase multiband compressor just to, like, inch out the last little bit of 5%. And then Pro L2 as my limiter from FabFilter, and that's literally it. Sometimes I'll change settings, but it's the same thing on everything.
Dope. I'm on your webpage. Where is it at?
It's, let me find the specific title. If you just look up, like, Make Pop Music Mastering, it should come up, because we don't do much stuff on mastering, but it was very highly recommended topic. Yeah, how to master your own mixes, then in parentheses, my mastering chain. It's 2 years old. I still use the same exact thing. I just swap around stuff every now and then.
Okay, I'm going to Google it real quick. Make Pop Music Mastering. Yeah, I was on, I just realized you had the blog tab. I was, you said how to master your own mixes, my mastering chain?
Yeah, it's on the YouTube channel. We did a video for it.
So I see it. I'm going to link it real quick. Okay, here we go. That's
it's
why
I respond. Like, I'm not a mastering engineer, so I don't try to overcomplicate it. Like, if I want to hire an engineer to go through and do phase shifting and denoise things and, like, send it to outboard analog gear, that's fine. I'll just pay their $75 or $100 or whatever, and I'll get their expertise. Other than that, I try to keep it as simple as possible, because here's another pro tip, is if you're going to mix and master your own stuff, pop on your mastering chain when your mix is like 70% done. So then you can finish up your mix into your master chain. That way you think that your mix is done and then throw on your master and you're like way over tweaking that. You could have just basically been done when you were finished with the mix.
Oh, that's actually bars. Basically, what did they call it? Top down mixing?
Yeah, I'm a big fan of, like, I like to get all the, like, general levels and balances and EQs, but before I go through and, like, do automation and, like, do the last little bit of, like, 20%, I'll pop on that master chain, get everything to, like, an industry level readiness and loudness, and then once it's there, that's where I'll put on my last little, you know, couple mixing tweaks, extra saturation here and there, extra de-essing if I need it, but that way I can make sure that, like, I'm understanding what the final product is going to sound like. I'm not guessing once I have that master. I have to go back and, like, redo the mix. It's just like, if you're going to do it all, just do it in the same session and just get it over with, like, play your 70% through your mix anyway.
I love that. Now we're talking real geek, because Mixbus TV, another, like, supreme, he's like an alien, I think. Do you know Mixbus TV? Austin?
I'm familiar with the channel.
Oh, okay, I didn't know. Okay. Because I was going to connect you guys if you haven't. But basically, he teaches how we should try mixing into a bus compressor. And that changed my whole mindset about mixing. He taught me, like, little small stuff. I bought a consultation from him before. And in 1 hour, he just flipped my whole ish. He flipped it all up upside down with a couple of techniques, just a couple of mindset shifts. So, like you said, mixing backwards or mastering, having your master chain there and then mixing into it can actually help you make decisions and understand stuff. I'll just leave it at that. Ricey's here. I'm going to let Ricey speak because he's on the left of me, so it's a little confusing on my screen. Ricey, wait, first of all, thank you, Ricey, for streaming so many cookups.
Oh, yo, sorry, my mic is muted, but yeah, thanks. I had something to say about that because, you know me, I joined this Discord, like, quite long ago now, probably about a month and a half, but I was a beginner, yeah, and I met V-Nice. You, of course, you know V-Nice. He's in beat battles and everything, but I met him and he taught me a lot about making music, because I only make drill, and he's obviously like a god at drill, so he taught me like a lot. And there's a lot of beginners now, because they're like coming at me now because I put my stuff in Beat Review on Friday and stuff like that. They all come in and they see me as Ricey. They all like, everyone's trying to get the style I do now. A lot of people who are watching the Beat Review, so it's just like getting me a lot of clout. So I just want to say thanks.
Right, that's, yeah. Thank you, Ricey, because thank you for explaining it perfectly. That's what I tried to give you as a benefit, because I see you all the time in there with V9. Like Marty is doing a cook up right now. I want you guys to know that what I'm bringing, hopefully you understand the benefit, is that you can leverage the audience that we've built, and you can build your own audience within our audience, and people start to respect you once they see you over and over again, and they start to look at you like an authority figure. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
But you're earning it, though. It's not like we're giving you anything for free. You're earning people's respect.
No, but there's also a lot of people who come in and they're beginners like me. I didn't really accept things, but I realized V-Nice was actually good. and was going to teach me something. They just don't accept things, which is sometimes annoying, but they'll get it. Because it will definitely help if they're trying to get certain bounces and stuff like that. I can teach them, obviously, because, like, I think I got invited to collab with, like, this collab is going to be crazy busy. I think it's me, V-Nize, Relo, 85 Savage, Tank, and Marty. They invited me because they now know that I have my own style. So, like, I'm going to get more clout off of that, obviously. It's just, it's all adding up, but yeah.
Wait, you said y'all all collabing? Did I hear you right?
Yeah, all six of us. We're doing the same melody and we all have our own part. So I think V-Nize goes first, then Relo, and then it drops into me. And then I think it's 85 Savage, Tank, then Marty.
Wow. For those who don't know, just Austin, just to give you context, when I say these are the most supreme music producers in our Beat Battle League that I've ever heard in my entire life, like, I mean that. We have a beat battle every Monday called the Beat Battle League, Austin, and it's a very specific genre of sound, and people can be like the best producer ever because they're not trying to get an artist on the beat. So it's just these extremely hard beats. And he just named off the top of the top of the top from our producer nation. And that's going to be insane. That's like the UN for freaking
That's what I mean. It's just all coming together because I started joining this Discord. Next, you know, I was talking to V-Nize. V-Nize talks to Marty. I get to know Relo. Like, Relo's also letting me and V-Nize, what's it called? Like, he does a beat battle every Friday as well, which I think, you know, because I always come into your beat review afterwards and choose the beats I submitted. But he's letting me and V-Nize host it this week because he thinks we're going to be good hosts and everything. So it's pretty mad.
Sick. That's what I'm saying. I love seeing you guys operate. Soundcrank, what's his credit? He said, put some respect on his name.
Soundcrank taught me so much about music theory. I forgot to mention him. He's the guy that put me, like, even though he makes a complete opposite genre to me, his mixing is so elite compared to everyone else. You can take so many tips from him. It's so crazy.
Gotta love it. Thank you, Bryson. No, thank you for the testimonial, because what we're bringing back, Austin, and hopefully you can add this to your community and blah, blah, and vice versa, whatever, is what's missing from music, I think, is apprenticeship. So when somebody would go study under somebody, like I learned this through in college, I tried to start a frat, but it got rejected because of it had a bad history. But in fraternities, it's like, okay, you have a big brother, we'll say, and then he takes care of the person under him. They call him, I'm forgetting all the terms now. My little, they call them littles. Okay, so you have a big brother and you have a little brother. And the big brother, even though he's not the biggest person in the frat, he's still coaching the person under him. And then that person under them coaches the person under them and on and on and on. And I think that's what's going to build this producer army over here. Yeah, and we're going to take over the world.
It's getting like that a lot now because people are coming to me specifically like they want to get my bounce that I get on my tracks now, because that's what I've learned. Like, I met V-Nize, taught me quite a bit about like how to do my slides on 808s, met other people, they taught me about like how to get better bounce, and then obviously I just evolved from there, like kept evolving, and I'm helping V-Nize back now by sending in mixes that I've got from other producers I've met. It's just, it's all adding up. So yeah, it's the Discord. It's somewhat like a home to me now, I've got to say, because I come in here like nearly every day. I don't know if you see. Yeah.
Yeah, but every time I load up I just saw Corbin, you hopped in, I just saw your face. Every time I log into my app or on the internet, I see Ricey's name. So I'm always paying attention to that. And my goal is to bring you guys a bigger audience and grow you. So thank you, Ricey. I'm going to create some more room here if you don't mind, because my screen changes. Yeah, it blocks out everybody on the YouTube screen.
Wait, before I go, sorry. There's that six-man collab I was talking about. Hopefully it's coming this Monday. I don't know, but me, V-Nize, Relo, I think Marty has done his part. All we need is 85 Savage and Tank. I think we're done, but hopefully you'll like it because it's like we all have each 16 bars, so you have to listen to it because we all have our own parts, but yeah.
Sounds super crazy. Super, super crazy.
Yeah, it should be mad, but yeah. I'll just... Actually, yeah, do you mind putting me... Because I don't want to exit.
Oh, you're all good. You're all good. Yeah. Thank you. We got Corbin. I just want to welcome Corbin to the stage. He helped us talk about royalties in music, I think 3 weeks ago, 4 weeks ago. However long ago that was. So shout out to Corbin for hopping in. DC Duke's on the screen. I forgot you guys don't know actual names or anything, but shout out to Corbin. You here?
Yeah, I'm here. I'm just listening in. Thanks for inviting me up, man. Always adding value.
Oh, you know, Clubhouse fam forever. All right, let's let some good folks in. So, Twin, what's on your mind, buddy? He probably fell asleep. It's been so old. It's been so long. Austin, did you have time? I didn't want to keep you hot as a hostage. Did you have time?
I'm good for a little while.
Okay, cool. So, Twin, are you there? What about Hatui? Hatui.
Yeah, I'm here.
How do you pronounce your username?
Atoy.
Oh, Atoy, what's going on? How you feeling?
I'm feeling good. How about you?
Chilling. What's on your mind?
Okay, so I started making music about 2 months ago, and I started using loops, like beats. And I got like kind of tired of like using loops. I wanted to do things from scratch. But the thing is, like, ever since I started doing things from scratch, I just feel like I'm getting stuck in my melodies. Like, I feel like all my melodies sound the same, and I wanted to learn, like, how can I improve that? I don't know.
What do you guys think?
Sweet. Yeah, I can hop in there. I think one thing that I always try to do is I feel like if I'm creating a lot of the same stuff is, like, I'll just try to play music outside of my computer. So, like, I have, like, a piano and a guitar and stuff like that. So if you have any instruments, or if you just want to pull up, a piano in FL Studio or Cubase or Ableton or whatever you use, play some sounds that don't have any production stuff. Just try to find new chord progressions. One thing that you could do is, you know, write down 5 of your favorite new releases, like 5 songs out of the past few months that you feel really good about. Figure out how to play those on keys or on guitar or whatever instrument that you can play, and then try to maybe make a song idea that starts with the same chord progression, and then you can go in and you can change the key, you can put it to a new tempo, you can swap around the arrangement of the chords, and maybe put a new top melody on it, and now that song that you kind of just reverse engineered the chord progression of is now a completely new idea. And that's one of the things that, like, I'll do if I'm feeling super stuck. You can also go download, like, a lot of companies will have MIDI progressions. I know my company has a couple packs of MIDI progressions. There's other companies as well. You can always download something like that, and then you can start to kind of tweak, you know, the tempo and the key and kind of swap things around. And that way you're still not starting with a completely blank slate, but kind of cutting down some of that time and some of the possibilities with, you know, getting stuck in just a loop of trying a million different chord progressions and ideas. Then once you can just find one, that's when you can start focusing on sound design and on the production, especially like if you're trying to make your own loop to kind of create a beat with. You know, go find a hip-hop song that you like, go listen to Northside Southside by Meek Mill or something like that, and then play that on your synth, and then say, okay, I'm going to pitch this up 3 semitones, I'm going to turn this up 20 BPM, I'm going to go ahead and swap around this melody note for this melody note, and then bam, it's a whole new song, it's a whole new start to a song, then you can put your own synths to it, and then when somebody listens to your finished product, they'll never even know that that was a starting point.
Darn. Mike was on mute, it was hard to hit the unmute button, that was deep. He said, build around it and then take... What, how did you say the last phrase? You said it way better. What's that last piece you just said?
Oh, my last piece was basically just like reverse engineer things so you can kind of start with your initial idea. So, you know, whether that's taking it from a song that you kind of flip or a MIDI progression that you find, get that idea down and then you can focus on sound design and then you can focus on the production stuff and kind of layering up with more sounds and adding your 808s or adding your drums or adding a vocal melody. Find some starting point that way you don't get stuck in that kind of loop of constantly having just a blank screen that you're staring at.
Right, that's actually really deep. So it kind of goes back to when we were talking about starting with the mastering and working backwards, having that structure. Because here's what the pros do that they don't tell you. And I learned this from the top guys who are making some of the top records. They basically will take, because a lot of artists have random requests. So I'll just say this top artist, I'm not going to name names because I don't know what they care about or not. Wanted an Isley Brothers record. They wanted a record that sounded like the Isley Brothers. So what you would do as a producer is you take the Isley Brothers record. You don't have to sample it. You just drag it into FL or Ableton. you build a track around the Isley Brothers track. Like, you get the same vibe, you get the same chords, like you're saying, reverse engineer stuff. And then you strip away the original Isley Brothers record, and then you're left with this new thing. And that's what they do on the top levels. And what I'm hearing is that you can get structure like that from Austin's templates and different things. You have chord templates, so you don't have to. And here's another thing, Austin, is that producers make the mistake of, they'll sit there and like try to make one sound perfect. Like Tupac said, he's like, look, pick a snare. We could change the snare later. Like, I want to get in there and record. Because most people lose their enthusiasm for their music because they're sitting there trying to fine tune this one synth. And what I'm hearing you say, Austin, is get the music right and you could always swap the sounds out later. Like, once you have the music, all you got to do is just click the next, you know, next until you get the right sound. Am I hearing you right when you're saying that?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, me coming from pop, I grew up as a guitar player and a piano player. So like, I write most of my songs before I even get into a DAW. That way I don't get that analysis paralysis of like looking at a million different synth VSTs and sorting through a billion different drum presets. Just like try to at least have the idea for the song. And something that I do is like, once I'm hopping into a DAW, that song is pretty much done in my head. I'm just like actually trying to lay it down. So try to like think your records through. That way you're not just stuck in the process of like always trying to reverse engineer your own thing. You know, it's just like, have that idea before you actually hop in. And just building that knowledge of things like music theory or learning how to play your instrument or learning your production tools, that's how then you can transport that idea from, okay, I can hear this song finished in my head, to now I can do this in my DAW in 2 hours.
Big facts. And I have a system on how to reverse engineer any chord using one note at a time. It's the craziest method. And it uses our chord code system. So I do it with the Anita Baker record. I did it with some other record, but you can literally take, you know how like in your head, Austin, you'll have this whole symphony going on?
Yeah.
And it's, I think people struggle with, okay, I hear 25 notes in my head, but I can only click in one note at a time because I don't know how to play guitar. I don't know how to play piano. And I have a system where I show them how to take one note at a time and literally figure out the chord that they're hearing in their head. It's a magical thing. But it, like you're saying, everything you're saying is, I back that up 100%.
As somebody who doesn't know a bunch of theory and doesn't have perfect pitch, I don't know how exactly your system's laid out, but I do something similar where, like, I'll just take the highest melody that I hear in my head, lay that down, take the lowest melody that I hear in my head, lay that down. So now I have a right-hand melody, I have my bass melody for my left hand, and then I can just fill out whatever notes in the middle I need to kind of thicken that up.
Dope. You want to hear it? Because you can't see it, I guess. But, like, let's say you have a jazzy chord in your head. Can you hear that? That piano?
Yeah.
All right, this is gonna be quick, I promise. I'm not gonna waste your time. Okay, so your head, you're like, you're hearing this whole chord, and what you're listening for in my system is the top note. That, and then you can work backwards using what are called chord codes. So I'm not gonna bore you guys to tears, but basically you can say, okay, let's try a minor 9 chord. It's a jazzy chord. So it's a chord code of numbers. So it goes 0, 3, 7, 10, 14. So you don't need to know what that means, but basically the top note is going to be the top number. So 0, 3, 7, 10, 14, 14, that's going to be the number 14. And as long as you count down your keyboard and fill out the rest of the chord code, you'll make the chord code. So it's easier seen than heard, but you have 14, 13, 12, 11, 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. You play all those together. Sorry, I'm clipping here, but you get a minor 9 chord. By reverse engineering that top note of the chord. So there's a whole system that I have. It's not too snobby. It's based in numbers. I just wanted to let people know.
I love that. That's pretty much exactly the same that I do in my head. So I love that.
Sick. I gotta show you my little quick video on that. So Atoy, does that help?
Yes, a lot. Thank you, guys.
Of course. Sick.
Dope. Tuck you in VIP. I'm going to let some more people up. So again, if you want to hop in the conversation, you got to hop on our Discord. My voice is getting a little sluggish, which lets me know we're on the tail end. So I want you guys to get your questions in before we run out of juice here. So I need you guys to hop on in. Just go to busyworksbeats.com/Discord. All right. So who was Granddaddy Beats? What's on your mind, buddy? If you can get the mic. Rocking Granddaddy Beats.
Okay, there we go. Peace. How you feel?
Peace to the gods. What's up, man?
God. I just want to thank you, man. I want to thank you. You have no idea, but I owe you big time, dogs. I'm a rapper, first and foremost. 2008, one of my homeboys introduced me to they were calling it Fruity Loops back then. And we didn't have enough music. And the guy who introduced me to Fruity Loops, interestingly enough, this dude was sitting on a gold mine full of beats. But anyway, we didn't have enough beats. And I got the bug. I wanted to start making beats. And just to kind of go back to the last cat you was talking to, Atui, this man, brother, you said he just started 2 months ago making beats. Is that what you said?
Was it 2? I missed that detail, but you picked it up, if anything.
I think he said it was like 2 years ago. Like, dude, spend some money with Game, get some of them classes, and learn some music theory if you want to create those melodies on your own. Because my personal journey, man, I spent over 10 years basically just like wandering around in the wilderness, you know, not being like tone deaf, beats were off key, you know what I'm saying? Like, I'm not understanding why people are not really feeling it and vibing it and everything. I had good ideas, but I would definitely advise that dude to definitely, you know, to spend some money with you guys, go to busyworksbeats.com and get into some of those courses, man, because I started looking at you about a year ago, maybe a year and a half ago on YouTube, and dude, you taught me so much, even just the simple little things about chords, you know what I'm saying, little tri-chords and stuff like that, just all of the little details that you give, the fact that you don't gloss over anything, man, it brought me light years. It literally took me listening to you. Sorry about that, hold on. It literally took me listening to you to get to the point to where I could listen to beats that I made and I was hearing songs, I was hearing lyrics.
Oh, that's a super dope.
Thank you very much for what you do, dude.
Oh man, I just love hearing back the results, because sometimes, Austin, do you feel this way? We just talk to a computer and we're just like, it's soulless. Do you ever feel that way?
100%, man. I know you have this Discord and I know you hop on Clubhouse. I have a Facebook community, which is actually how Make Pop Music started, as a Facebook community. And I have to say, dude, if I didn't have that community aspect of it, there's no way I would continue making videos, because like, you know, I know you have, what, like 800 something thousand subs. We have like almost 150, but sometimes that like human touch and that personalization only goes so far in a YouTube comment. But being able to, you know, hear people's productions that they're using our tips in, or, you know, see how people are using our sample packs, or give our own feedback on what people are doing, I think that that's kind of like really why we do this, and kind of, you know, the basis of kind of everything that we do. So, you know, having those community aspects and kind of being able to connect with people, it's a big reason that like we can continue making videos every week. It's because like have that human touch, it kind of shows us that it's worth doing.
Right, and thank you, Granddaddy Beats, because I'm telling you, there's people who haven't, like Austin told you, he's made nearly $500,000, if I heard you right, off of I forgot what you said, but people coming to you about being social and being online and different things. It's once you reach a certain, and it's not to sound crass or elitist or anything like this, but once we reach a certain financial level, like our business passed 7 figures, I don't even know how many years ago, like 2016, I think it was. No. What's today? 21, however long ago. I don't remember. 2016, 2017, somewhere around there, I forgot. But my point in saying that is that once you pass that point in money making, because most people are motivated by money, but once you pass that point, you don't care about money anymore. It sounds so stupid. You want to really make a change in people's lives. So what we do this for becomes transforming people. That's why I said Austin's at a level where he's, in my opinion, I see it because I see it very clearly, but he actually cares, and there's a huge difference. But thank you, Granddaddy, again. Wasn't scripted.
I just asked you guys one more question.
Go ahead. Yep.
Can you like tell me like a song or something I could listen to just to, you know, to see what you do and get familiar with you, because I'm not familiar with you.
Yeah, absolutely. I've released some stuff as an artist, so if you just want to hear like my music, you can just look up Austin Hull, Hull, on Spotify. But if you want to hear stuff that I've produced, there should be, if you go to any of our videos, there should be like a link to a playlist that's got a bunch of stuff I've produced. So like I could try to keep a Spotify playlist. I updated it in a bit, but I'd be able to find it if you look up on Spotify just Austin Holes Productions. Or if you go to a Make Pop Music video, you can click on one of the links in our description, and that should have it. Or you can just go to my website, austinhole.com. There's, you know, quite a few things up there. It's not everything. I've done a lot of stuff. I don't update it as often as I probably should, but it'll at least give you a good idea. And then if you want to see me in action, you can just go watch any of our videos. I try to, like, do literally as much as I possibly can on video. That way, it just answers as many questions as possible.
Right. I'll even say, just to back him up, is that you don't even have to go on SoundCloud or anything. Spotify and all that to listen. Every video almost on YouTube sounds like an actual record. That's why I respect this quality, because I don't even put in that much effort for YouTube videos, because it goes unappreciated sometimes. But insane value. What was the group? I put in facebook.com/, is it Make Pop Music?
Yeah, if you just go to facebook.com/groups/makepopmusic, that'll take you to the group. If anybody wants to join that's listening to this, it'll ask you a couple questions to join the group, just so we can try to like not have bots and spams. So just answer those questions, and then I or my wife, who runs Make Pop Music with me, or an admin will let you in within the next like day. But yeah, I think there's like almost 30,000 people in there. We try to keep it pretty clean from spam. Really cool. That's kind of how everything started, was like just as a Facebook community for like-minded people to kind of share what they were up to. And then that grew into me having a career, and then that career grew into me making YouTube tutorials, and then, you know, the rest was kind of history.
Gotta love just, it.
Mm-hmm. For you guys, if you could just, as you go on in your conversation and everything, lately what I've been doing is I've been taking MIDI files, you know, chord progressions and such and things like that, and I've been looking for the right sound, of course, that I want the notes to be played in. But then what I do is I kind of go in there and I change things around. What do you guys think about that style of production for building melodies and stuff? And thank you very much for speaking to me today. Have a good one.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you so much. I can answer that. I literally just did a song earlier today where I did that. I wanted to make music. I didn't really have any client work I needed to do, but I was like not really playing anything that I felt super great about. So I just like dragged in a chord progression from one of our own MIDI packs. I might have even made the chord progression. Either that or somebody that we hired that helps us out with the packs did. Dragged it in, changed it around, you know, took out the top melody, made the chords extended, and bam, built a whole song out of it in like 45 minutes. And if I was to drag in the original MIDI file, they don't sound the same at all. It's in a whole different key. It's at a whole different tempo. I put a different rhythm to the chords, took the top melody off. That to me, I picture packs like that, or you know, reverse engineering a chord progression from the song. I picture that as kind of like a digital collaborator. Like if you were in the room with somebody and they played a chord progression and you felt like that's cool, but I think that we should change it and go from there. That's kind of your job as a producer. And I think that going way, way, way back to the very start of the conversation, we were kind of talking about the difference between a beat maker and a producer. And a producer is somebody who can find an initial idea and then figure out how to best serve the song. So I'm a huge fan of that kind of technique.
Gotta love it. They were asking you, what DAW do you use?
I'm in Cubase 11 Pro.
This man has to be the only person I know rocking Cubase, but that means that that's how supreme you are, because I need to update. I think I'm on Cubase 5 or something like that.
Cubase is the best. To me, like, I started using it when I was getting really serious, and to me, it was just like the perfect blend of I came from like rock and metal and did some orchestral stuff, and it had like all of the tools and the live tracking that, to me, it felt like a good balance between something like live tracking and the editing and engineering aspect of like a Pro Tools. It was more modern and updated and kind of felt kind of similar to like an Ableton or like a Studio One. It felt like a really, really, really good cross-platform, and it's PC and Mac, so, you know, if I ever do want to switch OS systems, that's totally fine. But I know that you're an FL person, and I know that a lot of your channel probably is, but yeah, if anybody wants to try out Cubase, I could not recommend it enough. I've loved using it, and I work closely with the people at Cubase now, and they're the best.
God, I love it. The fact that you use it shows how good you are, because a lot of us can't even, like, we don't even know how to use Ableton, some folks in here. Jiraj, which I'm gonna let a couple more folks up. We're gonna try and speed up the question. So from moving forward with our Q&A, we're gonna do a hot seat, which means we're gonna give the person who has the question one sentence to ask the question and one sentence, and then we'll answer at our best because I wanna make sure we make this watchable because there's so much information.
Let's do it, rapid fire.
Rapid fire. So Jiraj, in one good old sentence, if you could ask what was on your mind.
Can you hear me?
That was your question. Yes, we can hear you. All right, to the VIP you go. No, what's on your mind, buddy?
So if you are starting with the music production and you are into synthesizers and you like to synthesize your own sound and you would like to start with techno, do you think it's a good idea to start producing music and then just upload it to Spotify and hope that it would get natural attraction? Do you think you need some kind of marketing, or is there a chance that if I, let's say, put out 10 tracks in a row within a few months, is there a chance that one of them will get traction?
That was like a question with 17 commas, but I let it slide. That was a long run-on sentence question. But basically he's asking, do you just put out music and just hope for the best? What do you think, Austin?
Yeah, okay, so here is my thoughts. This is why you can have multiple projects throughout your life. I've done so many musical projects that were started under an alias that I released music that I currently wouldn't stand by quality-wise, and that's totally fine because to me that was part of the learning experience. You have to feel like the only way to really grow as a producer is to finish things and put them out. So whether that's going to be on SoundCloud as like unofficial releases or under a Spotify, under an artist's name that might be just kind of work in progress, kind of expanding your own portfolio and your own expertise. I think finish as much music as possible, put that out. I would not expect insane results immediately, but once you have a song that you really do feel 100% confident about and you feel like, okay, I want to legitimately release this as an artist, definitely come up with some kind of release strategy. Even if you can't afford a marketing team, having some kind of visual, sending it out to playlist and kind of doing a little bit of research and planning it out for a month or two can really help, you know, make sure that you're not releasing something for only 40 people. However, I think that most people could benefit from a couple years of releasing songs where only 40 people hear them. I think it builds a lot of character, and I think it's the perfect opportunity for people to build up their sound and have the stakes too high.
I like that concept.
Nice. Thank you.
Alias, I like that. And Jiraj, I'll tuck you in VIP real quick just so we can keep the organization going. What I'll say is this, there's a lot of producer channels on YouTube who are doing song feedback. That's a really good way to get people to at least hear your music, to submit it for feedback, because we need songs to play and it's free playing. Like, you don't have to pay for it, at least in most cases. And what else was I gonna say about promotion? It's kind of like this Discord. The Discord is a growing producer nation. You can leverage everybody's attention here and build your own thing. So maybe try streaming on the, you see how many cookups we have? We have 1, 2, 3, we have 5 cookups going on right now on the cookup tab. So you could just stream one day. You don't have to be the best streamer in the world. It's free to stream. You don't need any external software. You just share your screen and can stream. Stuff like that, I think, will help you be seen more. I think a lot of people struggle with content. They just think they can put out product and that's it. You know, nowadays, you got to put out content. There's really no way around it if you're not running ads. So we got DJ Wraith is next. Oh, I forgot to unmute you. Give me one sec. There you go. I had to mute you because your mic was it was hot the whole time.
Okay.
We heard a blast of you. It was kind of like you ran by us at 3,000 miles an hour. Like, yo, how are you? Oh man, we can't hear you. He got on stage and now we can't hear him anymore. It must be the voice suppressor thing. If you go into your settings and turn off the voice suppressor, that usually messes up the voice. But we can't hear you though. Till Beast, you are ready to rock. What's on your mind? In one sentence, if you could excuse me, condense your question to one sentence, please. Oh man, cat got the tongue. We can't hear Till Beast. Can't hear you. Basquiat, what about yourself? Is your mic working? I guess everybody just fell asleep. Darn. Well, DJ Eddie King, you got the floor. What's on your mind? One sentence. Hey, one sentence question.
You can hear me, right?
Yeah, you just got to condense it to one sentence. Go for it.
Okay. Well, I just wanted to say, hey, shout out to BZ Works Beats. Shout out to Austin. Okay, my question is, I have two programs, which is also Vive and Drip. So I've tried to add these programs into my FL Studios that is giving me an error of missing items. And I was wondering, do you know what that could be?
Okay, for sure. FL question. So when you're, I'll show it on the screen for everybody who, you can watch the replay. I'm going to mute your mic because it's like this buzz and it's it's all good. So if you go into your options, go to manage plugins and then make sure your folder is in this folder list. You'll watch the replay and see it, but hit the little plus icon to add a folder. Then once you add a folder that you have the plugin downloaded into, most people forget where they installed stuff. Like every plugin does not install to the same folder. And that's the problem most people have. So you have to find the folder where you installed the plugin, add it to the FL Studio search path, and then click all these little buttons right here on the left side. Make sure they're all highlighted and then hit find more plugins. And then that should fix the issue. So it just sounds like FL doesn't know where to find the plugin. And also, you have to have a certain rescan function on. So that's how you do it. I'll talk you to VIP, but we appreciate you. Soundcrank, it looks like you're the last one. I'm running out of energy, so I'm trying to...
Yo.
Yeah, what's up?
So, like, my question is pretty similar to, not the last question, but the one before that. My problem is I've got loads of tracks that I've finished. I feel they're really high quality, but I don't know what to do with them. I'm wary of doing self-releases. I feel like they're really easy to flop, and I don't want this content to get lost in the ether, you know. So like, how would you approach going about getting in touch with labels and stuff? I've never done anything like it, but I feel like that's the right way to go.
Interesting. What do you think, Austin?
Yeah, so I don't work a lot with labels. Any of the artists that I do work with are mostly independent, and I just kind of meet them through... In the pop world, it's probably a little bit different. Typically, when we do a song with an artist, we're like actually hired out for the specific song at hand. I don't really have like a whole folder of unused stuff, but back in the day when I was kind of getting my start as a producer and kind of just working on as much stuff as possible, what you could do is... release the music, be okay with it flopping, but develop your skills as an artist who is steadily releasing, because eventually, if you're releasing enough good content, you're putting in a little bit of effort and you're being consistent, eventually the listeners turns into 100, 100 turns into 1,000, 1,000 turns into 100,000. With that said, doing a little bit of like research, you know, there's YouTube channels that kind of show you how to market your music, how to get on playlists, things like that. If you do want to self-release, is always fine. Don't be afraid to release something because you feel like it might not have a lot of listeners, because the only thing worse than not having a ton of listeners when you release it yourself is keeping it in a folder forever because you're trying to find the perfect home, and then that never comes. I have songs from 4 years ago that I wish that I would have just released when they were done. Instead, I held them because I thought this artist might want it, or that artist might want it, or maybe there will be a better time. And now the songs are just a little too old. I don't want to release them. Nobody ever came along to take them. And now instead of 100 people hearing them, nobody's heard them. So if you're a great producer, you'll keep making great things. Don't be afraid to put out whatever you're working with right now. Other than that, find artists that you really, really believe in that you can collaborate with. And that might mean putting up your portfolio to work with artists and not necessarily getting paid immediately. One of the things I did for years is I found a small group of artists that I really believed in. I liked their sound. I felt like they were talented and I needed to grow as a producer. So I helped them release music so they could build their name, which then in turn would help build my name.
Deep, my bad. I was trying to handle some files behind the scenes. So if you guys are seeing a black screen, it's because I'm handling some sensitive files to do the giveaway. And to answer you, Soundcrank, it's when people don't have control over the distribution, they tend to suffer when it comes to music. So, I mean, I would try the content route before I went to like leverage a label or people who are above you in the label system, because when you go that route, the only problem is that your destiny is in the hands of somebody else. And when you're in the music business, you can make money, but the problem is if you don't have control over your stuff, it's going to make you depressed. I mean, I can't tell you what to do. All I'll say is this. When it comes to the pyramid scheme of the music business, people are looking. There's a book by what's his name? Michael Gerber. It's called E-Myth. And the book basically is like this. There's three levels of business. There's the entrepreneur at the top who starts the business, the top of the pyramid. There's the second level underneath the entrepreneur called the managers. And they manage the workers who are at the bottom of the pyramid. There are a lot of workers. There are less managers. And then there's a very few amount of entrepreneurs at the top of the pyramid. So it creates like a pyramid shape. Now, most people who are in labels, for example, or dealing with labels, Warner is at the top. That's the top of the pyramid. Underneath Warner, you have the subsidiary. I'm just saying Warner. There's three companies, Sony, Warner, and Universal. Underneath those three, you have the subsidiary entities like Warner Chappell or Sony ATV, all the like companies that are branching out of the big brands. Then underneath the big brands, you have smaller companies like an MMG, Maybach Music, or whatever the like smaller labels are. So everybody kind of answers to somebody above them. And as long as you understand that that's how it works, you'll start out at the bottom as a contributor to somebody above you, you know, like a Cashmere or somebody like that. And then some people might not even give you credit though. So that's another problem that comes with entering that type of world. You might not even get credited because it means something to have the producer credit. It means financial gain. It means publishing. So I think it's to even be seen enough to even get on the radar for these labels and pub deals and stuff. You just got to be out there. I think you're making the right moves of being around the people here because we have people who watch and pay attention. And it's got to be seen. I mean, the number one thing is obscurity. There's so many people who we've read their username, but we don't know who the heck they are, what they sound like, what they like their voice sounds like. But for you, you keep showing face and people can, you stand out from the rest. That's the hardest thing to do. What do you think, Austin? What was the point where you kind of stood out from the rest of YouTube land, in your opinion?
Ooh, that's a really good question. Probably stood out, I think, when I was like really backing up my content with results instead of just like pushing hypothetical ideas. I think when, like you said, you can show face and you can kind of back up the advice that you're giving, you can show that it works. If somebody tries to discredit you, you can kind of check them. I think that's huge, you know? I think honestly being super honest with where you're at is also important because that helps build that credibility. So I'll never sit here and try to tell people how to become the next Max Martin or how to go land a deal with Island Def Jam or produce a Bieber record because I haven't done all of that. I have no experience with that, but I think where the breaking point for me and kind of make pop music is I do have experience with kind of building my own brand as a business. I do have experience with releasing music as an artist and doing a bunch of productions for people. I do have experience with creating and leveraging communities. And that's advice that I can give because I've done that. And I can prove that I've done that. I can show that I've done that. I can link to my Spotify portfolio. And doesn't mean everybody's going to like it. There's a lot of people that might be listening to this right now that when they go listen to my music, they don't love it. That's fine. But it's intangible. And I can prove that at least I'm here for a purpose and at least I'm backing up what I'm saying because we do get that like fake authority online. So as long as you're showing up, you're showing that you're really about it, you're showing that you have that skill, those connections will fall into place. It takes a little bit of time and I know it can kind of get impatient, but just keep putting in the work and it'll eventually come back around.
Good man. Yeah. And I think what people don't understand, they think, because I just had this realization today, and thank you, Soundcrank. I'm going to tuck you in VIP because we have a little line. I'm running out of energy, and I know everybody on YouTube screaming to do this FL Studio giveaway, which we will do. I just loaded up the entry sheet. So I'll just count up every entry, and then we'll do a random number generator, and whoever's number one will pick that person, and then they will win the FL Studio. With all that being said, that was a lot to say. Forgot what I was going to say. Darn, where was I going with that? I forgot what I was gonna say. Obscurity, I forgot. I'll come back to that thought later. DJ Wraith, is your mic working? He said he thinks he got it fixed, but we don't hear you. Oh, here's what I was gonna say. We have to do a lot more. Earlier, I was thinking about this because I had to set up this automated technical system so that when people made an order, it would pull it over. And it, basically, when people make an order on my website, it would go over to Asana and it would create a whole processing chart for a service, because we're about to bundle a vocal tag service into our black box bundle. Coming very soon, we're going to be collabing with Nicole Nix, which is ironic enough, you guys hear about her so much. So in our bundle, per customer, you're going to get a custom-made vocal tag, if you claim it, that is, in the black box bundle. So when I was setting that whole back end up, I had to make it so that Shopify had to talk to this other program, and that program had to talk to this other program called Asana, and Asana has to have all these things listed out properly so that it makes it easier for our team on the back end. And I'm realizing I'm doing much more than making beats. Like, if you had to map out what BusyWorks Beats tasks are, just to kind of give you guys an idea of how much effort goes into being your own brand, I'm not saying you need to do everything by yourself, but you got to know how to, you have to have different skills. So for example, you know how to make beats. Okay, good. We know how to make trap beats. It's a thing to even learn how to make different genre beats, you know, just beyond trap, you know, trap, dance hall, all the genres, whatever the genres are. Then you got to learn how to make videos. If you're a person on YouTube who needs to kind of edit videos, you need to learn how to use Premiere or whatever people use to edit their videos and make them more animated. I don't like to edit a lot. I'm very lazy, Austin. Do you edit your videos?
My wife works full time with me and she does the edits. And we've tried the whole, like, do a bunch of animations and a bunch of, like, clips and popping memes and shit in. But, like, we almost always just go back to, like, our editing job is to just make the video as easy to understand as possible and then not adding a bunch of the extra fluff.
Yeah, I'm like, you know, like, there's a certain line, I feel, this is my personal opinion, is that when videos become too meme-like and too animated, it kind of takes the seriousness out of it, and people kind of see us as jokes and not an authority anymore. Maybe we're entertaining, but it's not like we see you as the president. You know, the president's funny, but he's not a comedian. What's up?
I think it just does different things. Like, you look at somebody like, I'm a name drop, but all love. Like, you look at somebody like Composer Lily, where they're trying to do, like, a song in 7 minutes, throwing in tons of edits and tons of memes. It's super entertaining. You can still get a lot of information, but they're not claiming to give you, like, a 30-minute masterclass on how to mix vocals. So it's definitely, like, good content. It's just not the same thing. I picture it as, like, you go to listen to somebody give you, like, a 5-minute street performance versus you're going to sit down at a lecture and actually try to learn something. I think there's just, like, different strokes for different folks. But I don't think there's, like, a right or wrong answer.
Right. Somebody said Biden left the chat. That's hilarious. And yes, so I didn't mean to harp on that. But I was saying how we have to have different skills as brand owners and entrepreneurs. That's why I think separates a lot of people, too. A lot of people don't want to be brand owners or entrepreneurs. They just want to be a musician or just the beat maker or just they want a job. They want a role, a defined role. And what I'll say you guys need to skill up in is, one, you need to learn how to make your own website. Not that you need to learn HTML code, but you need to learn how to put together your own website, your own e-commerce sites. You know, you need to learn how to make thumbnails if you're doing YouTube stuff. You guys got to learn video editing to a degree, not a lot, but a little bit. You need to learn how to market and use copywriting, how to write sales pages. You guys need to learn how to set up systems on the back end, a follow-up system. Like, there's a lot of stuff involved with running your own company. It's not just making beats all day. And I think that's where a lot of people get stuck. And they're wondering, like, how do they just do that one thing and be successful? It's just not that simple. DJ Wraith, you're good to, you're here. We didn't unmute you. Your mic's not working, I don't think. So I'm not sure, we can't hear you though. So Basquiat, what's on your mind? If you could, in one sentence, did you already give us your question? I'm getting mixed up now.
No, I didn't give my question yet.
Okay, go for it.
So I wanted to ask, so when you export, what sample rate do you guys usually export at? I'm just curious.
It's a good question for Austin. Go ahead.
Yeah, for a final mix and master, when I deliver masters, what I'll do is I'll deliver 44.1 at 24-bit. I'll deliver 44.1 at 16-bit. I'll also deliver like a 320 P3. And then if they need anything extra, I'll do that. If I know for sure they're doing video, I'll send like a 48 kilohertz 24-bit. But other than that, that's pretty much it. And then in terms of what I want people to send me if I'm producing or mixing, I don't really care. Like, anything above 44.1, 24-bit is going to be fine. So, like, you know, if you're sending your stuff out to mixing and you want to send it 32-bit float, it's great, because it means even if you have clipping in your session, it's not going to clip in their session. But other than that, don't overcomplicate it. 44.1, 24-bit's totally fine.
Right, I was going to say, because do you record at a higher sample rate, Austin, than 44? I mean...
No, I mean, all my stuff goes to like 96 or like 128 or whatever. But to be honest, it just takes up a ton of disk space, and it's all gonna get cut back to 44.1 anyway. I'm not doing like these like 200 piece orchestras with $20,000 mics and $100,000 violin. Like, I don't really need all that extra like 2% for me to burn through my hard drive four times faster. So
big facts.
It's fine. If I go download the biggest pop record in the world right now, it's gonna give me like the lowest quality MP3. So like at the end of the day, don't waste a bunch of time and resources on like the 1%.
That was actually hilarious. He said it's gonna give me.
I appreciate an MP3. You, bro. I'm definitely gonna check your stuff out too, bro. So I
appreciate it, man. Thank you.
He's big fire. Like, I'm not even. There's no cap in my rap. I sound so old now. All my phrases. No cap in my rap. No, but yeah, because I export at 44.1 and just at. Because you said export at a sample rate. It's more so when you're recording, what sample rate do you use? But when you're exporting, I think people get caught up on the bit and you can like hardly hear it. I mean, you can, but it's in this, like it'll be on like the tail of a reverb of a guitar. Like it's in the spots that nobody really cares about is where the difference counts. And plus there's a theory where if you divide 44.1 into two, it gives you 2 point whatever K, and the humans can't even hear past like 16K. So there's a bunch of quality that nobody can hear. So that's my estimation. I know there's more merit to that than that. But anyway, to follow up, we got Moon Lord. Oh, wait, Tild, is your mic back?
Can you guys hear me?
Yeah,
cool. Hell yeah, cool.
How's well, going on, man?
So. Basically, I was just wondering, I'm trying to get some vocals into my beats now, and I don't know how to make it not sound so, like, I have a pretty decent mic, but it sounds so, like, homemade, you know, not really the vocals. I just can't get them to a point where they're, like, not sounding homemade, I guess, like, they're professional, you know?
Mm-hmm. Oh, right on, you with the vocal sauce. I'll give mine first. Because I don't know what Austin's willing to share. Do you have courses on this?
Oh, we have like a vocal engineering and a vocal production course. But I mean, we dive into vocals on almost every video. So like, if you want to see vocal change, like, I don't know what mic you're using, but a lot of people in here probably use an SM7B. We literally just did a video like 2 months ago on how to mix that. But I'm curious to hear your method. I can bake this down into like a 4-bullet point list.
Yeah, for sure. Because the way I look at it is, one, it starts with the mic. Like, for example, I would switch mics. But this mic's a little darker. It's the SM7B. And the one behind me is a Neumann U80. Now we can hear you. One sec, DJ Ray.
Oh, you can hear me now?
Yeah, you sound like you got the 8K crystal clear.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I'm going to come right back to you. I just want to... Make this...
Sweet.
So right here we got the Shure SM7B. So it's a little bit darker. Then you got the Neumann U87 behind me, which is brighter. So by default, you're getting a lot more detail that you wouldn't get from this mic. So what I'm saying is, this mic, even though it's good for podcasting and stuff, it tends to sound more clumped together because it's not as bright. So all the attention focuses around 200 to 400 hertz, especially with my deeper voice. So the first spot I look for is, I use a dynamic EQ, and you can use stuff like TDR Nova. It's absolutely free. TDR Nova, because FL Studio, does Cubase come with a dynamic EQ by default in the stock plugin?
Yeah, Cubase's stock EQ has dynamic options.
Oh, see, FL's EQ doesn't. So there's a plugin called TDR Nova that you guys can use, and it's free to use. And basically, you want to take out there's certain spots in your vocals that sound like this. You know, if I kind of put a hand around my mouth, there's a certain frequency. Usually, it's 200 to 400. One sec, DJ Wraith, I got to put you on mute. DJ Wraith over there partying. He's over there partying. So usually it's around 200 to 400 hertz. You're going to find that kind of muddy frequency. And there's so much to teach you guys. But look for, there's the only way to do this is to show you. But your voice is not just one frequency. You know, you have, okay, so I'll explain it this way and then I'll shut up. So when you're talking, I want you to hold the note like, and then you'll see on a visual graph of your EQ, you'll see your shape of your voice. There's like a little hill at the bottom. Look at it like a little hill. That's called the fundamental frequency. Your voice starts with a fundamental frequency. It's the lowest tone that your voice creates. And then your voice has what are called harmonics that extend up in frequency. So for example, if you're, you know, fundamental frequency was 100 hertz. That would be the base of your voice. Now the second harmonic would be 2 times 100, so it's 200 hertz. Third harmonic would be 3 times 100, 300. The fourth harmonic would be 4 times 100, 400, on and on and on and on. So your voice stacks up these multiples of a frequency, and that's what creates the unique shape of a voice specifically. So what most people do, they'll EQ just one of those hills, like at 100 hertz, for example, or 200 hertz, and they'll forget to EQ out the other muddy resonances, or we'll call them harmonics, that kind of make the voice sound muddy. So there's so much to go over, but that's why plugins like Soothe 2 are important, because it moves based on the frequency of the voice. It doesn't just stay static at 200 hertz, because your voice is not one tone. It moves around. Anyway, so a quick little solution is to use a dynamic EQ somewhere around 200 to 400. Just pull that back if you have a deeper voice like myself, and you'll notice this: your voice just sounds good. Most people use a high-pass filter at about 80 hertz, and that should clean up, so to speak, your voice. Then you can move into a compressor, which just makes your voice more like linear, I'll say. And then from the compressor, some people run into a saturator, or they do the saturator first into the compressor. Really, just it depends on what sounds good to you. And then they'll add another compressor, because with analog gear specifically, I can push my 1176, or my it's called a Mimas by West Audio. It's called a Mimas. I can push that, you know, negative 20 dB on my vocal, and it could sound good. But on digital plugins, for whatever reason, the way they're made, they sound crappy if you push them too hard. Most plugins, most compressors. So we try to split the work between two compressors so it doesn't have that digital squash terrible sound. So that's why you see a lot of people use two compressors on their vocals, not just one. Now from that point, once you have the EQ that's kind of cleaning up stuff, like I mentioned, the fundamental frequency, then you have the compressor, which is making your voice more linear. Then you have the saturator, which is just kind of taking off the transient peaks, and then you go into another compressor to just lift everything up. Once you have the technical crap done, everything else is creative. So that's, you're going to pretty much use the same vocal chain up until when you have to be creative with the vocals. And then most people would add another EQ for color. So that was a mouthful. But I'm curious to hear what you've come across. It's the last point I'll make with vocals is most people are trying to record way too loud. So you want to try and record at negative 18 dB up to negative 12 even. Some people go all the way up to negative 6, but that's kind of pushing it for most people. So you want to leave room for yourself to add all these effects. Most people, they record at negative 2 and they're like, why does my vocal sound crappy? It's because you're leaving zero room for anything to be added onto the vocal. It's called headroom. So those are my diatribes as to why or what to do on the average vocal. What do you think, Austin? What's my chain looking like to you? How do you feel about it?
Yeah, I mean, mine's super similar. Mine's basically, of course, you want to get the source signal as good as possible. So like figure out things like mic choice, where in the room you can track to kind of cut down on room resonances. And then things like proximity, like how close do you stand to a mic versus how far do you back away? Like right now, I'm speaking into the same mic, an SM7B. I'm about 6 inches from it. But hear how my voice sends out if I move it way back here. Now it's about a foot and a half away. I'm losing a lot of that bottom end. So if you're finding that your vocals are consistently muddy, back off the mic 6 inches. That's going to let you do a lot less work once you get into your DAW, kind of suppressing some of those muddy low mids and taming some of that sibilance at the top end. So once you have a good quality vocal, and in our videos, we'll show the vocal sounds like raw. So if you ever want to like hear a decently tracked vocal to kind of compare your source signal, go check out like a raw stem or something like that. Once you're in your DAW, I like to edit to time and do my tuning. And then once I've done the editing, it's very similar. It is control resonances and weird areas with something like an EQ. And then I'm compressing with something like an 1176, so super fast attack, fast release, that's going to catch some of those transients and smooth it out. I'm going to compress it with a slower compressor, so something like an LA-2A or a CL-1B. That's going to just kind of level everything out. Typically, I'm doing between like 5 and 10 dB of gain reduction per compressor. Then you're going to want to do something like DS to kind of get rid of some of that sibilance. And then I like to use another EQ so I can tame some of those low mids after I've done some compression.
Oh, did we lose you?
I'm still here. Can you hear me?
Yeah. Oh, were you done the sentence? It just sounded like you were going to keep going.
No, I think it just cut out for a second. Oh. Anyway, so I was just saying that, yeah, once you have like kind of gotten your compression and gotten all of those resonances handled, then it's just things like de-essing and kind of getting that vocal to sit in with something like EQ. Then a big area that I find people lacking on is not nailing spatial effects. So not having the right delays, not having the right reverb, not having the right chorus and doubling and things like that. Those are things that you can just set up on synths. They're super easy to do. We've done a lot of videos on that as well, but typically what I like to do is I like to send to some kind of doubler or chorus just to give me a little bit of width in my vocal, and then I'll send it to a short reverb, I'll send it to a long reverb, I'll send it to a stereo delay, send it to a slapback delay. And I can kind of just mix those into taste, and that's going to give me some of that spatial awareness. So once that vocal has a good frequency response and it's compressed to sit in the track, then you can actually hear all of the different rooms and delays and things like that. And that's pretty much my run and gun. The chain is obviously going to change on every song with every vocalist and every mic. But it's that basic nail the source, nail the editing, EQ, compress, EQ, DS, do a bunch of different fun synths, and that's about it.
I forgot about DS. You're right. And you made a good point about proximity. That's another thing. I'm so used to talking for videos that I'm close to my mic. You made a good point that I forgot too, which is me simply reminding myself, okay, it's time to record. Let me back all the way up a little bit. And that I found that out in my studio more so when I had a commercial studio, was that I was like really far away from the mic, like really, really far. And I was getting way better results on the vocals because I have a deeper voice. So it's harder for me when I'm close to the mic because I end up, my bad, I got my headphones all trapped under my chair here. I end up picking up a lot of that ambiguous, blurry sound, and it's impossible to EQ it out sometimes. Thank you for that. You said a lot of stuff. Also, some tools the pros use are NS1. If you guys have a lot of background noise, there's a Waves plugin called NS1, and then Soothe2. It's kind of expensive, but if you want the absolute cheat code for making your vocals sound clear and you just want a cheat code plugin, that is probably the most insane AI based whatever it is plugin, and it takes out all the crappy parts of your sounds. That's what the pros use. So just save money on a bunch of other plugins. You could just buy those two and be kind of good. So DJ Wraith, we're gonna unmute your mic for a second. My bad, it was
that's
hot.
Okay,
there you go.
Hey, can you hear me now?
Yeah, what mic are you using? It's like we got good high frequencies in it.
I'm using the mic on my Mac computer right now. I was trying to use the mic for my, when I make my music, make my tags and stuff. But it wasn't working, so I decided to just go with the internal mic from Mac. Oh. That's how I'm able to do it now.
Oh, sick. Well, it sounds, that was an advertisement for a Mac because it sounds like 8K, 10K, sounds crystal clear.
I turned it down to 50% sensitivity is what I did. And I think because I had it super sensitive, like 100% sensitivity, mm-hmm. It just like blew it out the water where you couldn't hear me.
Oh yeah, that noise suppression thing is, I don't know why they turned that on by default. It's like the weirdest feature. He said, yeah. In one sentence, if you could help, and Tilt, I'm gonna tuck you in VIP, thank you. In one sentence, cause I'm trying to wrap this up so we can do the giveaway. People have been waiting forever. In one sentence.
I gotta go in one second.
So in one sentence, DJ Wraith, if you could just ask what's on your mind, and we're gonna pick your thoughts.
The only thing I have to say is, is that I've been going by YouTube standards, the negative 14 LUFs and negative 1 up ceiling. How can we make it louder? Because even though I've done what they said to do, it puts my volume down even still. How do you fix that?
All right, yeah, I'll handle this one. I'm probably gonna have beef with YouTube mastering engineers after this, but like, I don't know who started the myth of negative 14 LUFS. I think it's because that's what like Spotify will normalize to. However, you can turn that function off in Spotify now, and not every streaming platform has that. So I don't master any of my stuff to negative 14. None of the professional top level mastering engineers that I know master their stuff to negative 14. And if you go buy a song right now off of Amazon and download that master file, I promise you it will not be negative 14. So here's how much room people are leaving on the table. I mastered a track to negative 14 just to see, and I was like, holy moly, that is very, very quiet. And then I downloaded the Meek Mill album that just came out. We have songs on there that are like negative 5. And that is really a lot louder. Yeah. So download some industry-grade masters, and you're going to be finding almost everything that I download as a reference is between negative 4.5 and negative 8. I have not downloaded a single professionally released master that is tighter than negative 8 or negative 9, maybe in like a quiet verse. Okay, I don't know who started the myth of negative 14, but no mastering engineer is actually mastering to negative 14.
So
it might get normalized.
Can I ask one more question? Now, even though you had those that loud, like, do you still have to keep the negative 1 up ceiling, or could you have it at 0? You know,
wouldn't do it at 0. I've heard of a lot of people. I don't do negative 1. I'll do negative 0.3, and that leaves 0.3 for differing and aliasing, which are like super complicated to go into, but as long as you're not like pushing it too hard, again, we're talking about like the last 1%. So unless somebody's listening on a $200,000 hi-fi system, they're not going to hear the slight little bit of distortion and aliasing. But the person that's listening in their car or on their iPhone, they will feel that low end more. And I think that the trade-off is completely worth it. So I typically master to negative 0.3 or even sometimes negative 0.1. And typically I'm at like negative 5 to negative 6 LUFS for like the loudest part of the song. But I did a master yesterday that was like negative 4.
Yes, I hear exactly what you're saying. Like the loudest part of the song is negative 14, negative 14 LUFs. But you try to have it as close as you can to, you know, like you said, like 0.3 to up at the ceiling, to 0 dB. I agree with that, and I was just trying to, because my stuff sounds really good, clean, mastered, you can hear everything. I was just trying to make it sound louder, and that's all I was trying to get at.
Push it a couple more dB and just see if you like it. Sometimes it'll change the dynamic, might take off some of the transients. I mix way over transient, so by the time I do have that super compressed master, I'm still getting that kick to pop, I'm still getting that snare to shine through, so yeah, just try it. Experiment, but definitely don't hold yourself to those arbitrary numbers. I don't think they really
matter. Yeah, because every time I do what they say, like everybody else's songs are louder, but yes, mine sounds clean, but it just, like, it's way lower, but it sounds crystal clear. Everybody likes it, but it's just not as loud as I think it should be. That's all.
Right. And there's so much knowledge in there. And I'm glad you taught people to move beyond that myth. We're always taught to.
I really appreciate that, too. To you, Busy, I love you. And yeah, love everybody you that has helped me. Because if it wasn't for you, Busy, I wouldn't be where I'm at right now. For real. Like, you've helped me so much. And I can't give enough love as I wish I could.
Oh, you the man. I mean, you come through like your family. I'm just going to have a big family reunion. I'm over the fear of being around people after my Miami party. I didn't have a mask on, and I'm still alive, thank God. But yes, thank you, DJ Wraith. It's always love over here. You're always spreading love, and that's one of the three things I was told in the higher realm. Spread love. And thank you, DJ Wraith. I'm gonna tuck you in VIP. Just oops, dang, my bad. I'm so sorry about that. Didn't mean to do that. But we're running tight on time, so I gotta wrap it here. I have to do a giveaway. And I wanna, so you said you want people to go to your Facebook. What's the link for today? Where should people go to keep up with you, Austin, for more information and more? Because I mean, you're a whole living book to us.
Yeah, I mean, if you just go to makepopmusic.com, I think that there's like links to pretty much everything on there. We've got links to the tutorials, we've got links to the community, we've got links to the courses and the samples. So if you go to makepopmusic.com, and if you, I want to say go to the contact page, there should be a, maybe it's not there anymore. Okay, so instead of going to makepopmusic.com, you can still go there if you want. Just go to facebook.com/groups/makepopmusic. You can join the community on there.
Oh, perfect. And,
oh yeah, if you click the Facebook icon on our contact page, that'll take you to the group. So yeah, all of that's on there.
Here it is. I'm pulling it up on the screen. 28,000 members on Facebook. Shout out to you. Because I know how difficult it is to build communities. I'm going to join. And hopefully I didn't skip the test questions or whatever it was. And I would highly recommend. So for those who don't know, maybe 4 or 3 years ago when I was in California, I forget how long I lived in California, 2018, he offered his Everything bundle. And I bought it right after seeing his Taylor Swift video, I think it was. So right now you can get the Ultimate Bundle. I personally bought it with my own money, and I vouch for this 1,000%. Whenever I'm feeling like pop, I'm just like, all right, Austin has the sounds. I'm just gonna go to all his pop kits, and they're super crispy clean. And then he has courses where I need to go through those courses again and just really grasp the way you think about music production, because I think that's where we have the most excitement, is when we see other people's process and we break out of our own mold. I think that's why we get so bored of everything, is we do it the same way every single time and we're expecting to have more fun the second time around, but it's like we're doing it the same exact way. So that's a testimonial from myself, and I would highly recommend it. Again, the one person who makes very thorough product in the producer community, there's very few. There's Ken Lewis, there's really, who else is up in that top tier? You know, Ill Factor's up there. He's in the mastermind. And then there's Austin Hall. Very few people can do what these good folks do. They're geniuses. So we are going to end this off. And thank you, Austin, for hopping in with this. Make sure you add him as a friend on Discord. And if you ever do make a Discord community, we'll go support that. And go hop in the Facebook Facebook group. I'll link that in the YouTube chat. And yes, now we're going to do a giveaway. But did you have anything else to shout out to the good folks?
Yeah, I just wanted to say thank you so much for having me. I've enjoyed getting to hang out and answer questions. And, if anybody else has any more questions, I'll try to pop on Discord. This is my first time ever on it. So I'll try to pop on here. But then, you know, if you ever want to comment on any of our YouTube videos or on the Facebook group, we try to answer as much as we possibly can. It's just me and my wife who run everything. So if you comment it, I probably will see it. I'll try my best to get back to you. And then other than that, I've had a really, really good time hanging out. The other people that you mentioned are huge inspirations to me. So even, you know, to be listed aside from them is an honor. So I really appreciate being here and kind of having the platform to speak. But yeah, I've enjoyed hanging out. And then I hope to kind of link with you all a bit more.
There it is. I forgot to mention MixBus TV, my bad. But yeah, you got a power couple over there. Him and his wife tag teaming to make this all work. So shout out to your wife for being supportive. And I think that's everything. So what we're going to do is do the live giveaway, and here's how we're going to do it, is we're going to go to see how many people are eligible to enter. There are 301-901-968. So there's 301-968 people eligible to win. We're going to hit generate a number on the screen, and number 170047 is the winner. 170047. So let's pull your email. 170047 is Lucas 301. All right, so if your name's not Lucas, you didn't win FL Studio today. So Lucas 301 is the winner. So we've been running ads, Austin, on Facebook, and I've been saying that we're gonna do an FL Studio giveaway, and today was the day I was gonna draw the winner. So that's what that was about.
Perfect. Yeah, I love doing giveaways. That's my favorite thing. We are probably due for one soon. So super glad I got to be here for that one.
So, yeah, we got to figure out ways to put you in front of, you know, the good old audience over here too. They need to know about you.
Let me know if you ever want to do a giveaway, man. I'll link up a bundle or whatever, and you can give it away whenever you want.
Sick. Well, you came to give wisdom. You came to give gifts. This man is prepared. No, but thank you. And we're going to wrap it here. My voice is gone. Corbin, thank you for, again, being Clubhouse gang as per usual. 978, forgive me for not hopping back to you. And Moonlord, forgive me not hopping back to you. I'm just really out of energy, and we got to wrap this live. But till next time, guys, I need you guys to subscribe on YouTube and smash the like button on your way out. Peace. Thank you again, guys. Peace. Well, how do I end this thing?